My name is Celia Navarro. I work for the Crossroads of America Council, and I'll be doing the Scout Oath and Law in Spanish if you guys would like to follow along. Juramento Scout. Por mi honor, haré todo lo posible para cumplir con mi deber hacia Dios y mi patria, y para obedecer la ley Scout, para ayudar a los demás en todo momento, para mantenerme físicamente fuerte, mentalmente alerta y moralmente recto. Ley Scout. Un Scout es confiable, leal, servicial, amigable, cortés, bondadoso, obediente, alegre, ahorrativo, valiente, limpio y reverente.
Hello there, fellow Scouts. I wanted to share the Scout Law and the Scout Oath from Sweden, where I'm from. So, in Swedish, the Scout Law. Ett. En scout söker sin tro och respekterar andras. 2. En scout är ärlig och pålitlig. 3. En scout är vänlig och hjälpsam. 4. En scout visar hänsyn och är en god kamrat. 5. En scout möter svårigheter med gott mod. 6. En scout lär känna och vårdar naturen. Och 7. En scout känner ansvar för sig själv och andra. The Swedish Scout Oath is quite straightforward. It's just saying that you will follow the Scout Law. But anyway, I will read it to you in Swedish. Scoutlöftet. Jag lovar att efter bästa förmåga följa scoutlagen. All right. I wish you have a really nice Friday night. Take care and always ready.
Hi, my name is Kitty and I'm a troop leader from Hungary. And this is the Scout Oath in Hungarian. Én, Rúnyai Kitty, fogadom, hogy híven teljesítem kötelességeimet, melyekkel Istennek, hazámnak és embertársaimnak tartozok. Minden lehetőt megteszek, hogy másokon segítsek. Ismerem a cselekvés törvényt, és azt mindenkor megtartom.
Good morning. My name's David and I'm the Cub Master here at Pack 180 in Fishers. And this morning I'll be reading the Scout Oath in Arabic. أعدا أبذل جهدي في أن أقوم بوجهي نهو الله ووطني وأن أسعد الناس وأن أحفظ قانون الكشاف.
الكشاف هو شخص جدير بالثقة، مخلص، مساعد، ودود، مهذب، لطيف، مطيع، مبتهج، مقتصد، شجاع، نظيف، وموقر.
Hi, I'm Zen Abelera. And I'm originally from the Philippines. I'm going to say the Scout Oath in Filipino. Panunumpa ng Scout. Sa ngalan ng aking dangal, ay gagawin ko ang buong makakaya upang tumupad sa aking tungkulin sa Diyos at sa aking bayan at sumunod sa batas ng Scout. Tumulong sa ibang tao sa lahat ng pagkakataon. Mapanatiling malakas ang aking katawan, gising ang isipan, at marangal ang asal. Batas ng Scout. Ang Scout ay mapagkakatiwalaan, matapat, matulungin, mapagkaibigan, magalang, mabait, masunurin, masaya, matipid, matapang, malinis, at makadiyos.
Prometo pela minha honra fazer o melhor possível para cumprir meus deveres para com Deus e minha pátria. Ajudar os outros em toda e qualquer ocasião e obedecer à lei escoteira.
Guten Tag, ich bin Ken Reinhardt. Mit dem Vertrauen in Gottes Hilfe verspreche ich mit Ihnen in Übereinstimmung mit dem Pfadfinder und Führer Gesetz zu leben.
Das Pfadfinder-Gesetz. Ein Pfadfinder ist vertrauenswürdig, treu, hilfsbereit, freundlich, höflich, herzlich, gehorsam, fröhlich, sparsam, mutig, sauber und ehrfürchtig.
Hi, I'm Maki. This is Japanese version. 近い私は名誉にかけて 次の三条の実行を誓います。1、神と国とに誠を尽くし掟を守ります。1、いつも他の人々を助けます。1、体を強くし心を健やかに徳を養います。掟。1、スカウトは誠実である。2、スカウトは友情に熱い。3、スカウトは礼儀正しい。4、スカウトは親切である。5、スカウトは快活である。6、スカウトは質素である。7、スカウトは勇敢である。8、スカウトは感謝の心を持つ。バイバイ。
Hello, my name is Mikhail and I will be doing the Scout Oath in non-Russian. Клянусь честью, что сделаю все, чтобы выполнить свой долг перед Богом и моей страной. Клянусь соблюдать закон скаутов, всегда помогать людям, быть всегда физически сильным, бодрым и морально выдержанным. And now I will do the Scout Law. Скаут всегда надежен, верен, готов помочь, дружелюбен, вежлив, добр, послушен, весел, рационален, смел, чистоплотен и благопристоен.
Hello, greetings from Denmark. Spejderloven. Som spejder vil jeg gøre mit bedste for at finde min egen tro, at værne om naturen, at være hensynsfuld og hjælpsom, at være til at stole på, at have respekt for andre, at høre andres meninger og selv tage standpunkt, at tage medansvar i familie og samfund. Spejderløftet. Jeg lover at holde spejderloven. Spejdermotto. Vær beredt.
My name is Matthew. Today's Scout Skill of the Day is the Cub Scout Essentials and the Scouts BSA Essentials. So we're going to start with the Cub Scout Essentials. You see, the first and probably one of the most important essential for really any hiking or camping event is, of course, a first aid kit. Now, depending on what the activity is, will kind of depend on what you need in your first aid kit. But this is a really simple first aid kit. It has chapstick, it has antiseptic wipes, it has, you know, Band-Aids. Very simple first aid kit, but of course, very important. The second of the Cub Scout essentials is the water bottle. Now, it's very important that it is a filled water bottle. Oftentimes, we forget to do that prior to our outing or hike, but please make sure it is filled up and make sure you have enough water for till the next time you can fill up your water bottle. So if it's a really long hike, you may need two water bottles, but that really depends on the outing that you're going on. The second Cub Scout essential is a flashlight. You need to make sure that it has batteries and it works. As you can see, my flashlight does work, so that's perfect. So that would be perfect. You can use a headlamp or a regular flashlight, whatever you would like. The fourth Cub Scout essential is trail food. Now, you can of course make your own. You can use a granola bar, protein bar, trail mix, really anything that would really kind of provide sustenance while you're in an outing. The fifth Cub Scout essential is sun protection. So in this case, I'm using a hat and I've got some sunglasses here just in case it gets sunny, but sunscreen would be another thing that would be pretty important, especially on a sunny day. And then the last Cub Scout essential is a whistle. Now, this is a tool, not a toy. This whistle is really in case of an emergency so that you can alert others that you need help. So just a reminder that these are really all tools, not toys. So really, the rest, I'm going to now kind of pan out a little bit and look at all of these. These are all the Scouts BSA essentials. Very similar to the Cub Scout essentials minus the whistle, but essentially it's got the same things: first aid kit, filled water bottle with enough water for whatever activity that you're doing, a flashlight or headlamp, trail food, sun protection, and this is where we start to see some differences. In the Scouts BSA essentials, they ask that a pocket knife be included, make sure that it is sharp and ready to be used. a map and compass of the area that you're in. Now, it's not worthwhile bringing a map that is not for the area that you're in, so a map and compass, both very important. Extra clothing, so especially on a hike, that would include, you know, socks. If there's an opportunity for it to get cold, make sure you're having the proper layers. Make sure you pack extra clothing. This is another important one, which is fire starting. So I've got a lighter and matches. Just in case the lighter wasn't to work, I have a second opportunity. And then this is the last one on the list of 10 essentials for Scouts BSA, which is rain gear. It could be a poncho or it could be a rain jacket. So these are the Scouts BSA 10 essentials. Talked about the Cub Scouts earlier, the 6 essentials of the Cub Scouts. To our parents, if you're looking for a way to practice this skill and really help make sure our Scouts remember these essentials, you could play a game similar to the Kim's game, where you have a bunch of items on the table and you ask the Scout to pick out those essentials for that particular age group, Cub Scouts or Scouts BSA. So it could be a really good opportunity to kind of test and whether they have understood and know why those are the essential items through that game. Don't forget, please like and share this video. Share the video with your troops Facebook page or other at your district or whatever it may be. Please like and share, and thank you, and see you next time.
Joining me for Scout Skill of the Day. Today we're going to be talking about a very important foundational skill for doing lashings, and that is tying our clove hitch around a post. So this will be a very important knot that we use both for starting and finishing many of our lashings. So let's review the clove hitch today. So to start with, I'm going to do a crossing round turn, which means I come around the post and I cross the rope over itself to make a nice little X like this. Okay. Then I bring my working end around the rest of the way and I feed it underneath the X. See, bring it right under the X and pull it through, and that gives me my clove hitch. Now I know I've got a good clove hitch as opposed to an overhand knot if it separates like this and makes an H or an I shape, and then pulls together like this when I pull on the ends of my rope. Okay, let me repeat that for you so you can see it really well. So we're gonna make a crossing round turn. We're gonna bring our rope the rest of the way around, pass it under our X, and then pull it tight. Now, it's possible, and you may have learned this trick, to tie a clove hitch outside of the rope and then slide it on to the end by doing 2 half hitches. Okay. While there's nothing wrong with doing it that way for other purposes, like if you're hitching your horse to a post, when you're doing a lashing, it's really important to be able to tie it around the post like this, because while you can start it by sliding it over the end, you won't be able to use it to finish. You need to be able to tie it around the post. So make sure you get some good practice in on this, and you'll be ready to go to start your lashings.
Cadets from the 2003 Wildlife Officer Training School walk to the podium to take the pledge and receive their diplomas. For many of them, this will be their career choice for the next 30 years.
Eric Lane, State Wildlife Officer, assigned to Perry County, and I've been on for 10 years now.
My name is Jose Ramirez, and I've been with the Ohio Division of Wildlife for over 16 years.
I've been with the Division of Wildlife for approximately 10 years.
It's an occupation that was made or designed just for me.
A wildlife officer's motivation often comes from the gut. They believe in their work, conservation, and as law enforcement officers.
Law enforcement is a very tight-knit community. You'll find that different police agencies, from the State Highway Patrol to sheriff's departments to municipal departments. The Division of Wildlife is no different. As a matter of fact, I think we're probably, as an officer corps, more tight-knit than some law enforcement agencies.
We're kind of a close-knit type family in the unit, and all the guys work together real well. We just, everybody gets along. Whenever something needs to be done, we all pitch in together.
We train together, work together, so we form friendships and also a good professional relationship.
I feel like we have some of the best training.
We do a lot of training throughout the year, and our instructors are trained real well to teach us how to handle various situations that we may get involved in.
The training is some of the top notch and some of the best, and we've got some of the finest instructors.
6 months at the academy, just taking us through a pretty intense time, and plus after the academy we have training 6 times a year. We have anything that comes out, if we need it and we have a reason for it, we probably will get it. The division's very good about giving its officers and employees top-notch equipment.
It is a wonderful job, but being able to work your own schedule for the most part. You get good equipment. As you can see, I have a nice state vehicle to do my patrolling in, and you know, it's just wonderful getting out there and seeing some beautiful country. Kind of hard to retire from that.
I wish I would have started sooner. I wish the 9 years that I have at this other company, I wish I would have had those 9 years with the Division of Wildlife.
As a wildlife officer, you have so much opportunity. As it's if you wanted to be a biologist, if you wanted to do education, you could do all of those things as a wildlife officer, because you are in the county and you have, you can call a wildlife area manager and say, hey, I want to trap turkeys with you guys tomorrow. Would you mind that? Or you're doing an educational, you're doing a program, you're doing public speaking.
You never know what's going to happen today. I interacted with first and fourth graders for 5-6 hours. Tomorrow I'm going to be out checking bow hunters, so it's never the same.
I can make a difference. I love to teach. I love to talk to the youth. And most definitely, I like to enforce the game laws of the state of Ohio, so they're around for a long time. When I get up and jump into my truck, I could be doing a host of different things. I could do up to 20 or 30 things in one day that are totally different from each other.
I worked in a factory for 2 years, and then I decided this is not what I want, and I remembered that contact from that wildlife officer, and from then on I had a goal, and that was to be a wildlife officer. It was definitely, I have to say, more than what I had expected. The Division of Wildlife is like a family. Once you're in a position for quite a while, you get to know people and they become like family. So it's much better than I ever expected.
It's the greatest occupation on earth, and before this, I always tell people that I wanted to be a comedian, but people laughed at me for that, so I quit that and came on with the Division of Wildlife.
I've had a couple of younger guys call me and talk to me, ask me about the job, and want to know my thoughts about it. And I tell them that they can't go wrong with this job. It's amazing. It's amazing 24 hours a day. But I tell them they need to make a decision early that that's what they want and go after it. You go through volunteer, you go stop at a wildlife area, go to the district office, let them know who you are and that you're interested. But mainly you need your education. You need to graduate and you got to have all the requirements made. And don't give up. So you can get this job if you want it. If you want it bad enough and work hard enough, you can have this job.
Thank you.
You know, Benji, we probably need to make a plan before we just take off.
I think we just go along.
We'll be fine.
It's fine.
Hi, I am Miles Eisen. I am from Sylvania, Ohio, and I am from Troop Run 54. We are making sourdough biscuits today.
All right, buddy, what you're going to want to do is take all your dry ingredients, pour them into the stainless steel bowl, and stir everything until it's well blended. Yeah, we said it was sourdough biscuits. Okay, so what you just poured in was a cup of flour, 2 teaspoons of baking powder, and 3/4 teaspoon of just plain salt. All right, make sure it's well blended, buddy. Is it well blended? Let's see. Let me help. Actually, that does look pretty good. All right.
It is actually quite easy.
Yeah, we made a little bit of a mess.
Yeah, we can.
All right. Now what you want to do is pour your butter in there and mix it until all the butter is well blended, okay?
How much butter is that?
Here. That is 8 tablespoons of grated butter. Use a cheese grater to grate it. Make sure you get it all out of there, bud. There you go. Now mix that until it's well blended, okay? Thank you. Okay, let me see it. Let me see what your progress is there.
Did you break up all the balls too?
Sorry. No, I think that's good enough. You've actually done a pretty good job. Okay. That actually looks pretty good. Now, what you want to do... I'm going to break up a few of those too. Let me help you here. All right, break those up. And while you're doing that, I'm gonna talk. So, the next ingredient is going to be your wet ingredients, and that's just sourdough starter. To make your sourdough starter, start with 2 cups of just plain all-purpose flour, a cup of lukewarm water, and just 1/8 teaspoon of yeast. And then you just put it out on the counter for about 4 days. Loosely cover it. So this is my sourdough starter. I started this 14 days ago, and you just cover it with a dish towel, and you want it to bubble up and double in size. You know your starter is ready when you take just a small little tiny bit, throw it in some water, and if it floats, it's actually ready to go. It will smell sort of like a sour smell, a general sour smell. So if you have that, you know you're ready with your starter. One of the things about sourdough starter, you do have to feed it and continue feeding it. And that's why recipes like this are pretty important when you make sourdough, because you've got to pull off a cup probably every other day and then find out something to do with it. Now, I use Fleischmann's dry yeast. You can use your own cultures, or actually just leave it open with the dish towel on top of it, and it will pick up yeast from the room, but I was a little impatient. I just wanted to get it going. So I used the Fleischmann's dry yeast. All right, buddy, that actually looks pretty good. Why don't you add the sourdough? Use your spatula to get all this starter out.
Pick it up, there you go.
As far as your starter, when you do pull your cup of starter out, take another cup of all-purpose flour, put it back into the starter with just a 1/4 cup of lukewarm water, and then just set it out again if you're going to use your starter within the next couple of days. Or you can store it in the refrigerator. Make sure you stir it up really well. Or you can store it in the refrigerator and use it at a later date. All right, let me see that. Here, use this side of the spatula. See what I'm doing?
Yeah, you scrape it all.
Yeah, you scrape. That's what a spatula is for. See what I did there?
Yeah, it's clean. Oh, well, almost.
Okay. And I think that's good enough. Why don't you stir that up and take this over to the sink. Blend it well, buddy. Do you need my help?
I'm trying to get her off the wall. There we go.
Here, let me help, buddy.
Now, are there any rules to this? Like, you shouldn't use a mixer or anything like that?
Yeah, biscuits, you don't use a mixer. You shouldn't use it. The dough should be relatively tacky, very sticky. You don't want to use a mixer with your biscuits. And you don't want to overwork them either, because then you mess them up. It makes for tough biscuits.
Sure, should they be relatively just a little wet?
Yeah, just a little wet. Make sure they're well blended, which I'm having a little trouble with. That's why I took over.
They're really hard.
Yeah, I know, buddy.
I should mention that both of these guys washed their hands right before
yes,
we started the
we
video.
Yes, we did. We did wash our hands.
Always very important when you're making food.
They kind of fold your dough over and just mash it together. And you'll end up with a consistency sort of like that.
Okay.
right, Miles, you want to continue? Well, I'll let you go on here in a minute. Let's get these out of the way. We don't need these anymore.
You can keep on mixing that, buddy. The job, right?
Mm-hmm. It's harder and since it's metal, it's a bunch easier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think we've actually got a pretty good... Here, buddy. And then what do you want your dough to look like? It's basically tacky, sort of like that. You take a little piece of it off.
Not like cookie dough.
It just kind of just sticks together.
Not like cookie dough.
After you've rolled your flour out using a rolling pin or a glass, you actually can make a biscuit cutter. We used a can of chilies, washed the can out really well, that we had for the chili that we're making, and then poked holes in the bottom of it to make a biscuit cutter, and you just cut your biscuits and you place them on a greased pan. Today we're actually not going to use a greased pan. We're using these really neat anti-stick surfaces that my wife picked up. So, all right, buddy, why don't you cut those biscuits? Start from the edge and work your way in, okay? There you go. As close together as possible. You did a really good job.
Good job, Miles.
Thank you.
Oh, careful. Here. There you go. Now you're on the edge. You were a little over. Okay? We're going to have a little bit of biscuit dough over. We'll make a biscuit out of that. Get it close as possible. There you go.
Probably what you're
going to get. Yeah. Okay, so now our biscuits have all been cut. We've got everything spaced out appropriately. Your oven should be preheated to 375 degrees. Put your biscuits into the center rack of the oven. Bake for 20 to 23 minutes until they're golden brown. All right, buddy, why don't you open the oven for me? We'll take that over. Think? You want to try the first one?
I'll try the
second one. Well, hot.
The second.
No, I'm getting the second one because I actually did the
baking. All right, and none of them stuck. All right, why don't you guys give them a shot? Tommy, you want one?
Careful, don't burn your mouth, okay?
Ooh,
steamy.
What do you think?
Tastes like sourdough.
That's it. So, what do you think?
Good.
Well, hello again, everyone, and welcome back to another Scout Skill of the Day. This is a special edition, which is My Favorite Not Monday. we are going to go through my favorite knot, the bowline. Now, the bowline is very useful in terms of self-rescue. You could tie this knot if you needed to help rescue yourself. It is easy to do, and it is also found in your Scout Handbook. This is found in a number of merit badges and advancements, so very useful knot for us to review today, the bowline. All right, so we have here our rope, and you're gonna need about maybe 6 to 8 feet of rope to truly practice this the right way. So we have our running end and our standing end. Now in our standing end, we wanna make a loop. So just make a loop, bring this back behind, and you'll see right there where the standing end then goes off and it's behind the loop. Now, your running end is gonna come up through the loop that you've just created, around the back, and back down through the hole. And we're gonna pull that tight. Now that is what a bowline looks like. Now, if you need some help remembering this knot, there is a little story that goes along with it. So, what I want you to do is, this is the rabbit, and we make the tree over here that has the hole in it. So the rabbit comes out of the hole, runs around the tree, and dives back into its home, and then you pull it tight. And that is the bowline. We will see you back again for another edition of Scout Skill of the Day. Please continue to follow this, and I hope that you continue to build your scouting skills at home with your family. Thanks a lot.
Hey everybody, this is Rob, the Director of Customer Service at the Crossroads of America Council. I'm excited to be here for another Scouting Skill of the Day. Today we're going to talk about setting up tents. This is, in the grand scheme of things, a very easy thing to do, but it takes some practice. If you haven't done the practice beforehand in your backyard, guaranteed that first camp out, when that tent comes out of the box for the first time, it's going to be dark, it's going to be cold, it's going to be windy, and it's going to be no fun for anybody. So the first thing we're going to do before we even pull that tent out of the bag is we're going to figure out where we want to set it up at, and we're gonna make sure the ground is clear. We're gonna take a quick minute, we're gonna pick up a bunch of twigs and debris off the ground here where we're gonna set it up, and we'll be right back. Okay, so we've got the ground all cleared out here where we're gonna set the tent up. We've got a Gannett 4 tent by Peregrine right here. This will be the first time out of the bag for it, so we'll be setting it up together for the very first time. Okay, so we've taken the tent out of the bag and we've got a bunch of different parts here we've gotta deal with. We've got a footprint, we've got the body of the tent itself, we've got a rain fly, and over here we've got poles and we've got tent stakes. First thing we're going to do, we're going to grab the rain fly right here and we're going to lay it out on the ground. Okay, we've got our rain fly all laid out. Fantastic feature about this one I did not realize, it's got a logo on the footprint. Logo face up, that means the tarp is face up. Convenient as all get out. Now we're going to lay the tent body over the top of it. Because this is a two-door tent, there is no front and back. We've got doors on each side of it. So we're gonna lay it out nice and flat and right over top of the footprint itself. Okay, we've got the body of the tent laid out right over top of its footprint. Now we're gonna take the poles and we're gonna get them all set up and into place. Now most of the tent poles you're gonna come across are gonna have this elastic shock cord in them, which means they're all connected into one piece. You simply have to assemble them and get them all flat together in one section. Okay, you can see we've got two long pole sections right here. This is easier to do with two people helping you, but it's very capable to do by yourself with just one. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this end of the pole right here. We are going to insert it through both of these grommets that we see at the base of the tent, right here. And now we're going to run to the other corner. We're going to grab this end of the pole and we're going to do the same thing over here on this end. And you're going to see how that pole flexes and bends up just like that. We're going to let it fall over the way it is and we're going to let it rest there while we do the other one. All right, so we've got both of our main cross poles in place in the corners. Obviously the tent body isn't set up yet. So all we're gonna do to start is we're gonna grab the very center hook you see right down here, and we're gonna lift it up into place, and we're gonna clip it over both of those poles at the same time. Just like that. Now we're gonna go through and we're gonna attach all of these hooks along the sides. All right, it's starting to look like a tent. We've got all the clips in place on all the poles. We see the body all set up. I opened up one of the doors just because I felt like it. Now the next step is going to be getting the rain fly in place over top of the tent body. It's not a necessity, but if there's a chance you're going to have bad weather, if you think there's going to be rain, it's always a good idea to have it set up. If you know you're in the clear, it's not a requirement, it's not a necessity. You can leave it nice and open. You can see the stars up in the sky at night. Totally up to you. But we're gonna go ahead, we're gonna get this set in place real quick. Okay, the rain flies over the top and in place. Last step is gonna be staking it all out. I'm gonna do a quick side note while we're here. If you look right down here at the hook where the rain fly attaches to the body of the tent, you'll notice this is all the same color. This is green, and this down here is green. That is the case for every single one of these all the way around the tent. It's not a problem, but it isn't necessarily as user-friendly as it could be. If we look over here real quick at the Eureka, you'll see this is yellow, and the bottom, the base of the tent, is yellow too. Every other one on this particular tent is black, which means if you match up yellow to yellow, that rain flies in exactly the right space. So all we did was take some yellow electrical tape and we put a piece here and we put a piece here on this. What that means is when we set this up the next time, we're gonna know if we match up those two colors, everything else is gonna fit and work perfectly. So the last thing we're gonna do, we're gonna take our tent stakes and we're gonna stake this tent out into the ground so that if our wind does pick up, it isn't gonna blow anywhere on us. All right, we've got all the stakes in place. We've got them in the corners, we've got them down along the side, and we've got them here holding our vestibule out. And this tent is officially ready for sleeping in tonight. We hope you guys enjoyed the video. Please like it, share it, tell your scouting friends about it, and continue scouting at home. Thank you.
Being prepared for changing weather can make or break a trip, but it can leave your pack feeling heavy. Check out these tips for how to travel light and plan for the weather. Plan ahead and prepare by making sure to check the weather report before you set out. Pay close attention to the temperature, humidity, wind, and any rain or snow that might be in the forecast. Knowing the weather and conditions can help you travel light by packing only the things you need. When researching a trip, check the trail conditions for things like ice, snow, mud, high water, or other hazards that might be present. Read recent trip reports and ask a local ranger station about the current conditions. This will help you stay safe and determine what equipment to bring and what you should probably leave behind. You can plan for the weather and go lightweight by leaving bulky clothes behind and dressing in layers. Instead of one bulky jacket, consider bringing two lighter layers to wear on top of each other. It will keep you warm and it's easy to adjust if the weather changes. Because the weather can change without warning, we always recommend bringing a rain layer along with you. A lightweight rain jacket can protect you from the elements and those unexpected circumstances. Plastic bags have many uses and can make a nifty, lightweight addition to your gear list. A dry pack is a light pack. A thick garbage bag like this can be an inexpensive do-it-yourself pack cover that can keep your backpack dry and light on the go. Are you looking for a lightweight way to keep your feet dry on the trail? Try bread bags. They're inexpensive and they can help keep your feet dry so that when the weather gets soggy, your socks don't. Whether you're preparing for a day hike or setting out for the backcountry, planning for the weather can help you stay safe, prioritize your gear, and keep your pack light. Enjoy your world and leave no trace.
Hi everyone, Subaru Leave No Trace traveling trainer Caitlin Sutterheim here to teach you a fun and interactive way to both learn, remember, and teach our 7 Leave No Trace principles. Now feel free to follow along. Principle number 1, know before you go. Principle number 2, choose the right path. Principle number 3, trash your trash. Now we're going to pretend our fingers are a trowel to dig a cat hole. Principle number 4, leave what you find. This includes wildflowers and cool things like antlers. So leave what you find. Principle number 5, be careful with fire. how we do our rule of thumb to make sure we're a safe distance from wild animals. Principle number 7, be kind to others with a peace sign and a high five. Well, hope that helps you out, and we'll see you on the trail.
Hello, my name is Kevin, and I'm going to show you how to edit a video on iMovie. So the first thing you want to do is to create a new project, and I'm going to choose this, and so this is only half of it, so in order to add on more to this movie, you go to the plus button and you go to videos, go to recently added, or all, doesn't matter, and choose a video that you want to upload to iMovie. In this case, I want it to be this one. And,
so why did you need to put two videos together, anyway?
This is only half of it, so, only part of it. Also, we do have something else in here that we do not want.
Of f of x dx. Get out of my room!
Yeah, that, okay. So, in order to edit that out, we go to the moment. You go to the moment that you want to cut out, and you see this little split button down here. Push that, and you go through, and go to the part that you want to start back at. In this case, it's right there. And then you delete the rest. So now.
F of x dx.
Go ahead.
Okay. So that also didn't really have any sound, so we would probably want to cut that as well. So I'm going to go to the part where
from 0 to from Newton's talk. From 0 to 7.
So right about
from 0,
right about there.
From 0.
Yep, right about there. So we can cut out the rest of this part. You push the delete button and
DX.
Go ahead.
Hang on. Alright, should work now.
Of x dx from 0 to 7. Then we have work.
And the rest of the video runs smoothly. Also, you can edit in sounds as well. So you can go to the plus button, go back, and you have audio as well. Or you could just record whatever, or voiceover.
So how did you learn to do all this? Did you just have to kind of play around with it?
Yeah, explore, do stuff with it.
All right, well, thank you for showing us how to put two videos together, Kevin.
Yeah.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome back to another edition of my favorite Not Monday. Now, last week we worked on the bolin, so I hope that you've had an opportunity to practice the bolin. If you haven't, here's a quick refresher. Again, you have a running end of the rope, okay, and then you have the standing end of the rope. And in the bolin, you want to make that simple loop under and then come up through, around, and back in. Again, that is the bolin. Last week's My Favorite Knot Monday. Now, for everyone who's already practiced the bolin, we are going to work on the figure eight. Now, the figure eight is most commonly known as a stopper knot, meaning that you could tie it, and if you were using it to maybe put up a tarp or put up a tent, it would stop and not pull through, say, a grommet, for example. So let me show you how to tie the figure eight. Now, we have the running end and the standing end, and all you want to do is put the running end back behind the standing end, come across, and then put the running end back through that loop that you made facing yourself. And when you pull it, you can see it makes a figure eight shape on both sides, and then you pull it. Now, if you pulled this tight, this would not allow for this rope to be pulled through a grommet. Now, for those of you out there who might be climbers, you might have also heard of the figure eight on a bite. If you're not aware of what a bite is a simple loop in a rope. Now, if we tie a figure eight on a bite as such, and we go around and then back through, the figure eight on a bite is one of the most common climbing knots that we see. This can be used if you're preparing to clip into a harness, for example, or clip into a rope. So real quick, let's go through one more example and we'll try and get a close-up for you just for the very basic figure eight. So we go around behind, over the standing end, and then we pull that running end back through the loop that we made closest to ourselves. And that is the figure eight. Join us next Monday for another edition of My Favorite Knot Monday.
Thomas and Commissioner Pugsley. Pugsley is a camp commissioner and Camp Kithlewinan, and one of our favorite parts of any camp is a campfire. I'm here to tell you about two key ingredients to a campfire, skits and songs. Now there's an arc to a campfire, so your skits and songs are a little bit different at the beginning than at the end. Skits can involve a whole patrol or den, several people or just a few. And they're the entertainment. They're usually pretty raucous and funny. But make sure that they're scout appropriate. And if it's a skit that might kind of make fun of somebody at the end of it, make sure that that person is in on the joke. It's an absolute requirement. Don't just pick somebody out of the crowd. That person is a performer just like everybody else and needs to be okay with the skit. Songs, well, they're the energy that electrifies the crowd. They're the way to get the whole crowd involved and pumped up. They can be really loud, they can be repeat after me songs, and they can also be songs that involve lots of movement and getting the crowd up on their feet and moving around. They're truly full participation from the audience. And again, it's what electrifies and adds energy to a great campfire. Now, as the campfire goes on, usually towards the end, we start to settle down. Sun might be settling, campfire starting to get low. Skits and songs still happen, but skits tend to not be raucous and funny. They usually are more story-based or ceremonial-based and provide time for reflection or inspiration. So do songs. They can be inspirational as well. But a great thing about a good song is that it's something that you can teach the audience and everyone can still participate in. Even songs that might be a little bit more somber. So make sure you take time to teach the songs to the audience and make sure it's something that they can easily learn. A great song will bring a campfire to a reflective and inspirational close right before some sort of scoutmaster or campmaster or camp director minute at the end in an official closing. So that's skits and songs. Commissioner Pugsley's ready to go out and have his evening campfire. I hope you have a great weekend.
Hi everyone, welcome back. It's me, Spencer, and today we're gonna build wind cars. Wind cars are a super fun, hands-on activity you can do with just very few materials and still be a scientist and make discoveries, and in fact, you get to be an engineer. So wind cars, I said they're very few materials. Here's all I'm using today. I have straws, some paper, this safe, postcards. I'm gonna have things, cars need to have wheels. So I have these Lifesaver mints, but you can really use anything. You could use Lego wheels, anything with a hole in the center that you could attach, or you can figure out your own way to attach your wheels to our straws or to something else, which is gonna be like our axles. I'm also gonna use some tape to put it all together. And then I have cups so that I can build my wind car and have it catch the wind. So there's a few things. Your wind car design should probably have four wheels to begin with. And I would save the wheels as one of the last things that you work on, but make sure that you do plan to have wheels, and the wheels need to spin. So I'm gonna make my wind car using one piece of paper as the base, and I want my straws to go across the bottom. So I'm gonna do this. Once I have that, I can start to answer the question of, now that I have a base for my car, what am I gonna use to catch the wind? So you have to do a few things. You have to think about what sort of wind course are you gonna use? I have a fan over here in the back that I'm gonna use for my wind source. But you may just wanna go outside and use the wind outside, or heck, you can blow the wind yourself, whatever you're gonna use. But you need to have something that's gonna catch the wind and decide what that is. Now, if you don't have a cup like I'm using, you could make your own wind catchers. You can make a sail like on a pirate ship, or you can fold a piece of paper into a cone. You could make it a big wind car or a small wind car, whatever your heart desires. Just remember, it's all about testing and having fun. So how fast does your wind car go? You could use a handy dandy stopwatch or a phone to record how fast it's going. You could do distance. How far do you want your wind car to go? Whatever you decide, just make sure you're designing, you're having fun. So I've been building my wind car, and this is my wind car to start. You see, that's four wheels. I've decided to add tape to the ends so that it could, so that my wheels don't move. And then we also have a base in which I've tried to fold over the paper so that my wheels rotate independently. You don't have to do this. You can do this however you want. Let's see what happens. I'm gonna give it a try. Here's my car. What do you think? Think it's gonna work? I hope so. If not, how can we try again? What can we do to make this the fastest wind car possible? It worked. Wasn't perfect. You see, it went to the side, but I'll just have to try it and try again. So go forth, be an engineer, make a hypothesis, build it, test it, redesign it, and show us your wind car down below. Have a great day.
Are you new to hiking? Here are some tips to start hiking the Leave No Trace way. Whether heading out for a walk in your city, a local park, or a bigger outdoor area,
know before you go.
Adequate trip planning and preparation can help you accomplish trip goals safely and enjoyably while simultaneously minimizing your impacts on the natural world.
Poor planning can result in damage to natural and cultural resources and can put yourself or others at risk.
Good planning can increase self-confidence and opportunities for learning more about nature while on the trail.
Here are a few elements to consider when planning your hike.
Identify your goals, skills, and abilities, and those of anyone else who may be joining you.
Learn about the area you plan to hike in, either through maps, literature, or land managers when applicable.
And make sure to bring your map and compass with you. There may not be cell service in the place you are visiting.
Choose equipment and clothing that is functional and comfortable.
Get an idea of what the terrain will be like, keep an eye on the weather forecast,
and make sure to pack extra layers so that you're prepared for any weather.
Make sure to bring plenty of water so that you stay hydrated and healthy on the trail.
Now you're ready to start hiking the Leave No Trace Way.
As you know, our slogan is, do a good turn daily. For Thankful Thursday, our theme is sending messages from afar, and we are the experts. We have a lot to be thankful for, and one of the best things about scouting is learning about opportunities to help those around us, making our community a better place. A lot of us are getting restless, all while our senior citizens are lonely in isolation in hospice care, nursing homes, and assisted living facilities. With today's project, there is a solution for both of these struggles. So, one of the things I encourage all of us to do today is to take a moment to send messages to senior citizens in our community. Who might need a positive message? Well, maybe it's a grandparent, aunt or uncle, or other senior family member, or maybe it's a neighbor or friend of the family. Maybe it's one of our senior citizens in your community you've never met. So what can scouts do today to help while everyone is staying at home and maintaining physical distancing? A lot, it turns out. Assisted living centers for senior citizens and hospitals across the country have had to go on lockdown for the safety of their residents and patients, which is for their physical health, but has left a lot of people feeling alone in a stressful time. Residents are used to having visitors and being in close connection with the community, so they feel very isolated right now. Let us all take a moment to bring joy to senior citizens in nursing homes and assisted living facilities who are cut off from the outside company during this pandemic. This can make an enormous difference to residents. It tells them we're thinking of them, we care about them, we're anxious to see them again. It's also a great way to teach our kids how to be compassionate and kind during this time. From your house, send messages of kindness through words, and a brief meaningful message or a piece of artwork can really brighten someone's day. Letters from one generation to another to help ease loneliness in these unprecedented times. Don't worry, the United States Postal Service gives this kind of project its blessing. In its update on its COVID-19 response on its website, currently there is no evidence that COVID-19 is being spread through the mail. We can write personal message in a card or a note telling someone about our day, our latest scouting adventure, or your favorite thing to do at camp. We can post a positive message on social media. We can create some artwork, take a picture and post it, or mail it to a senior living community. Be creative. Work with your parent. Make sure you're sharing all of these messages appropriately using the CyberChip guidelines. So how can we send a message? Work with your parent to identify a local senior community or nursing home. A simple search online for senior living near me will give you many of local options. Thanks for participating in this Thankful Thursday. Make sure you're sharing your notes with us using the hashtag CACImpact. And please make sure you challenge your den or patrol to send positive notes this week to our senior citizens. Thanks again. Have a great day, everyone.
Hello, this is Thomas with Camp Kithawinen. One of the things that we do at family camp at Camp Kithawinen is fishing. So we're here for today's Scout Skill of the Day to talk about how you can do backyard fishing right at home. So assuming you have a pole at home, ideally a smaller pole is better for the kids, but any pole will work. rather than having a traditional hook on the ends, just about anything that provides a little bit of weight will work. This right here is just a clothespin with a little eye hook screwed into the ends. But you can also use a small yo-yo that's lightweight, and again, just about anything that provides just an ounce or two of a little bit of weight to act as your bobber and weights. And to do this at home, you set up your backyard very much with either some rope. We have what's called the backyard bass out there, which is an item that you can purchase online, but you can also use paper plates or any sort of marker or towels, anything that marks different areas out in the grass. Now, depending on your skill level, if you're younger, haven't learned how to cast too much, again, start easy. One of the easy things to do is actually to be really close and just flick upwards a little bit and practice your accuracy. As you start to develop your skills, rather than casting forward and practicing your accuracy that way, do not go swinging wildly side by side. You sometimes see people cast that way. That's really not a good way because it's really not accurate. You just nice and light overhand. You can get a lot of distance, and I went way too far onto the tree there. So make sure you have enough room and don't go as hard as I did, so. But then you might see I can practice getting close to where the different fish are in the river or lake. You can keep practicing in the backyard and try to get as close as possible to landing your lure right on one of the fish. I hope you enjoyed today's scout skill on how to fish in your own backyard. If you enjoyed today's skill, definitely check out our summer camps this summer, where hopefully you can go fishing.
Is the shear lashing. This is one of the required advancement lashings, and hopefully something you'll find to be useful in your daily life. So let's get started. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to do a clove hitch. You may recall from my demonstration, we're going to start with a crossing round turn, bring it around, pass it under the X so that we have a nice clove hitch to start. Okay. Now, the shear lashing is used when we want to connect two poles that we can then wiggle back and forth and separate. So we're going to do this with two poles today. So that's the definition of a shear lashing. However, we can also do this with three poles to make a tripod lashing. So as you can see, I've got my two poles. They're nice and close together. I've got my clove hitch. Now what I should do is I'm gonna take the ends of my clove hitch and I'm gonna sort of twist them together, okay? Which allows me to anchor my clove hitch so it won't pull out no matter how hard I might pull on these on this rope. So now, having wrapped those around, I'm gonna wrap it around the other post, okay? And then I'm going to start to alternate. Okay, I'm going to do, basically, I'm going to form a figure eight between my posts. Okay? This process is called wrapping. Okay, so as you can see, I'm going back and forth between my two posts. And I'm trying to keep my wraps nice and close together. Okay. So I keep doing this, going back and forth, and I want my wraps, so I want this distance right here to be about the same as this distance right here. So it's going to actually make sort of a squarish shape. OK, Okay, that to me, that looks like we're about doubled up right there. So now I'm going to, this time when I come through between rather than continuing to wrap, I'm going to do what's called frapping. And frapping is where I wrap around the rope, but not around the posts. So you can see I bring my rope down, I put it between my two posts, I pull it nice and snug, I bring it up through my two posts, down through my two posts again. Okay, so I'm gonna do this twice. So I've got this many wraps and two fraps, okay? It's not like you get at Starbucks, these are fraps. Okay, and then you're gonna pull this nice and tight because it's your fraps that help hold all of this together. And then your last step is you're gonna do a clove hitch. And remember, in my other video, I indicated it was really important to be able to tie the clove hitch just like this. So I'm gonna go around, and look, I'm going to make that crossing round turn just like I did before. And then the last thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna slide my working end right here underneath my X. See, it came through right here. And this is really important. Don't let it get loose, okay? See, I don't want a bunch of loosey-goosey in here. I want this to pull through, and I'm gonna work my slack through in between all of my knots until this is also nice and tight. Okay, there it is. And watch this, look. I have the ability to separate this so that I can make an A-frame. See, if I put some posts across the bottom, I can make a nice strong A shape. Or as I mentioned before, I can use this to, with a third post to make a tripod. So my third post would then extend through here to support my two posts. So thank you for joining me today for the shear lashing.
Thomas Barrington with the Crossroads of America Council with part two on wilderness navigation. Last week I talked about the map and why it's the foundation of all navigation and how you can truly often navigate, even in a wilderness environment and a wilderness trail system, with just the map alone, when you know how to interpret all the symbols and information that a map contains, and when you utilize it consistently throughout your travels. But there's also another very popular tool, and that's a compass. A compass is something that all scouts want, and it is one of the essentials, 10 essentials for scouting. One of the most popular versions of a compass that we often see is just a round compass, usually with a lid and then this little peephole sight that pops up. Those are very good compasses for shooting bearings, and one of the key skills that a scout's BSA learns is how to shoot a bearing. However, those compasses aren't the best design for utilizing with a map. For that, a compass that looks more like this, with a big, flat, and straight base plate, really is the compass you want for working with a map. And trying to find a compass that has a mirror to help shoot bearings, which is what that round compass design does really well, helps with that, shooting the bearing, but also if you get one where the cover is in line with the base plate, you just extended the length of your straight edge. Is that really that important? The answer is yes. When you start to use map and compasses together, especially for plotting your course or finding where you are by shooting a bearing, you'll find quite often that you're going to need a longer straight edge than what you might have when you're backpacking or hiking. That's why if you can get it in your compass, it's so important. There's a lot of things on a compass. There's magnetic
north. So this really what's orange on my compass, but is red on most of them, is the magnetic side of the needle, which will point towards magnetic north. There's the 360 degrees of the dial, which also rotates. There's, you probably hard to see, but there's scales, different scales on here, both inches and centimeters. Again, there's the mirror, there's some sight lines. This particular version also is glow-in-the-dark features. Another thing you might see is there's this little black arrow that's pointing down. And as I turn it, it's still pointing down. You know, most compasses just point north. This particular one, with the straight edge, I can also measure the slope of an angle. That's a pretty technical skill when it comes to wilderness navigation. There's also some other non-navigation features where being able to do that, measure the angle of a slope, can be pretty useful. So you can also find that in tools. This particular compass also has the ability to what's called set your declination. Now, what's declination? It's the difference between true north and magnetic north. There is a difference. And here's another thing. It moves and changes. That's right. The declination in one area, the difference between magnetic north and true north today, will be different 20 years from now. That's because magnetic north actually kind of wobbles around true north. Now, here in Indiana, the difference between magnetic north and true north really isn't that great, and you don't have to worry about it too much unless you're truly traveling off of a bearing, off of a direction on a compass for a long period of time. Now, if you were backpacking or hiking in the state of Washington, the declination could be 15 or 20 degrees. That's a lot. So even over a short distance, you could end up in a very different place if you don't take into account declination. Again, this particular compass actually has this fancy little screwdriver here and a little tiny screw way in the back, and I can set the declination for the area that I'm in. Don't forget to check it and reset it when you travel. I've learned that one by mistake. Another important aspect of a compass is actually this right here, the string. And trying to find a string or lanyard that doesn't stretch. Much like the straight edge, having a string and something that doesn't stretch to utilize with a map is actually quite important. One of the things that you might do quite often is to try to figure out how far you're going to hike or have hiked. I know this is a little bit hard to see, so I'm actually going to use this as a boundary line. Actually, I'm going to use this boundary line right here that moves. I can take the string and start to measure that path. And now I know that while it wasn't a straight line, I can take that distance and measure it to the scale on the map and find how far I need to hike or I have hiked. So having a bendable edge, but again, one that doesn't stretch. I also speak from experience that all of a sudden you thought you had to hike a lot further than you did because you accidentally stretched that cord while you were measuring the distance on a trail. One other kind of unique thing about a compass that a lot of people don't know is, did you know that there's different magnetic fields to the earth? And a compass in one place may not work in another. So for example, if you were to buy a compass for the magnetic fields in the northern hemisphere and then took it to the southern hemisphere of our planet, it would not point to true north. It will also get caught and not spin correctly. There's also compasses, and actually this compass is a world compass and is balanced, the needle is balanced to work in all five magnetic zones. Now, truth is, unless you know you're traveling internationally, you really won't have to worry about that. But that's just one of those little tidbits sometimes people don't realize about how a compass works. There's a ton of information out there. Actually, REI.com, the retailer, has a great tutorial both on maps and the parts of and how to use a compass, I suggest seeking out that tutorial on their website. I mentioned the book Staying Found last week, and again, I absolutely love that book and its viewpoint of about always just staying found and knowing where you are to begin with. But another great book that I want to mention, kind of sounds a little odd, but is Be Expert with Map and Compass. This is definitely more for our Scouts BSA. It's a little bit of a tougher read, but it gets very technical if you really want to learn about how to utilize a compass with a map. It too also goes into detail about map-only use as well. So that's our primer on wilderness navigation. Again, map first, then compass. And we talked about GPS last week. That's an advanced skill, but the map and then the compass is the foundation where every scout should start.
Gear is an important piece of any backcountry trip. And while backpacks and sleeping bags can be really exciting, don't overlook your backcountry poop kit. Having a dedicated bag for your poop kit helps keep everything organized and sanitary. Inside ours, we have five main items. There is hand sanitizer, a towel, toilet paper, a way to pack out that toilet paper, and a wag bag. Hand sanitizer is important to use after any backcountry bathroom expedition. It minimizes the risk of contaminating while cooking and keeps everyone from getting sick. While you can dig a cat hole with a rock or a stick, we like to carry a trowel. Not only does it make it easier, but you can easily measure 6 to 8 inches deep for your cat hole. Remember, you also want your cat holes to be 200 feet away from water, trails, and camp. And you might notice we don't have a tape measure in our poop kit, but we can still measure 200 feet by taking 70 big steps. We also carry toilet paper and a way to pack that toilet paper out. We have just a small amount of toilet paper, no need to bring the entire roll, and what we like to call a FOPO bag. It stands for fear of packing out. This is just a Ziploc that's wrapped in duct tape. You can put your used toilet paper, pads, tampons, anything like that in there, and then all of it can get packed out so you can leave no trace. Our last item isn't always going to be necessary, but is good to carry as a backup, and that is a wag bag. This is a way to pack out our solid human waste. In some areas, these are going to be required, either because you can't dig a cat hole, because waste won't break down, or because there are just too many visitors. Always remember to check local regulations before you head out on your trip. You can always add more items, but having these essentials will help you leave no trace on your backcountry trip.
Thomas from Camp Kithlewinen, and today I'm going to demonstrate some of the different types of stoves you may see while camping or at home may help you with your challenge this week, the cooking challenge. So there's three main types of stoves I'm demonstrating. There's electric stoves, gas stoves, and then liquid gas stoves. The first one, a lot of people have this at home, is just a gas stovetop. Very simple. I'll demonstrate how to turn it on. That was hard. They're really just that simple. You turn it on, it heats up, and the burner is ready to cook. The next type of stove, and these are much more popular for actual camping, is some sort of two burner or single burner gas stove. These typically are propane or isobutane. They have a canister to them, and there's gas in here. It's in a gaseous state when it comes out of the burner. Very easy to light as well. Simply turn it on, you'll hear some gas, and it's on. You may not see it, but there is heat coming off of this right now. Again, very simple to light, and you can control the amount of heat and flame with the knob. That's why they're very popular, having these pre-canister stoves. The last type is a liquid fuel stove. So this is much more popular in backpacking small stoves like this, although you can find liquid fuel stoves in the bigger two burner you just saw. So with a liquid gas stove, this bottle is filled with a liquid gas. This is specifically white gas. You have to go and pump up the pressure inside this container. Once there's pressure in there, you turn on the knob, and I'm not going to demonstrate this, I'm just going to describe it. The liquid gas will go through this tube. You'll see it goes up and around, and you turn it on just a little bit, you'll see a little bit of gas end up in this bottom cup. You turn it off right away with just a little bit of gas down there. You then go and light the little bit of gas down there. You'll see yellow flame. This one will be very visible. What that is doing is actually heating up this tube right here. Now this is physics and chemistry at the same time here. When you heat up this liquid gas, it is then turning into a gas state. You'll see the flame from here start to what I call jump up to the burner. When that starts to happen, you start to turn this back on again. You gotta do it slowly, because if you do it too early, this will literally go whoosh with a big fireball. That's why these are a lot more complicated, takes a lot of practice. Definitely have to practice these outside, not inside. So those are the different types of stoves: electric, a canister gas, and a liquid fuel stove. I hope you enjoyed today's Scout Skill on the different types of cooking stoves. Continue learning at home. If you thoroughly enjoyed today's demonstration, we certainly hope that you join us this summer at camp. Barrington with the Crossroads of America Council. Today's Scout Skill is going to be a little bit longer because it involves one aspect of a pretty complicated topic, wilderness navigation, something that's important for every good scout to truly have a good grasp on. Now, there's a lot of different things when it comes to navigation that people like to use. Probably one of the first things that come to mind is what really is newer technology in terms of navigation, that's GPS. We use GPS units quite often in the wilderness, and we use them in National Youth Leadership Training as one activity. But what if the battery goes bad? All of a sudden your GPS unit doesn't work. Then what are you going to do? There also can be a little bit complicated to use and navigate the menus and the screens with. So that's an advanced form of navigation. Another thing people think about is a compass. That's also a very useful tool. But without a reference information, a compass doesn't really do much more than point your direction. You need some sort of reference bearing, such as a pre-planned emergency bearing to evacuate from an area, or you need a map to orientate your surroundings to. Then you can utilize the compass. Oftentimes, scouts really like to have that compass with them. But the truth is, with really good knowledge on how to use a map, you could navigate on a good wilderness trail system without ever even using your compass. That's why map skills is the foundation of all navigation. Now, this might sound like an odd question, but one of the first things to ask yourself is, what even is a map? It really could be a whole bunch of different things. I actually geek out on maps quite a bit. You know, I even have a textbook about maps that I read for fun because I love maps so much. You know, they can be pretty simple and be orientated towards a building and how to navigate a building, or they can involve a whole bunch of data points over a much bigger area, or could even be a map of the entire world. But they can get even more complicated than that as well. I like to always challenge people with a few things. Would you recognize this page as a map? That's a map of the London Underground. It's a system map. It's not drawn to scale or anything, but you start to learn how to navigate the subway system. What about that stick figure over there? Would you recognize that as a map? It is. It's actually a chart for navigating the waterways around the Marshall Islands. It's from the 19th century. There's even maps that are literally just carved sticks into wood, or for, again, navigating shorelines.
something that a lot of people wouldn't think of as a map. When it comes to wilderness navigation, though, there's really a gold standard, and that's a topographical map, usually from the USGS, the United States Geological Survey. You can actually go to usgs.gov, learn a whole bunch about topographical maps and the different types of maps the government produces. You can even download those maps or purchase hard copies of them from usgs.gov. There's also maps that are custom made for very popular areas such as Great Smoky Mountains. This is from the National Geographic. There's other companies out there as well that make topographical maps for popular backpacking and hiking areas. And these maps are very similar to USGS topographical maps, have just a ton of information on them. These maps literally can have millions of data points. On this map alone, I can tell you depths of water, the topography of lands, how high or steep a mountain's gonna be, distance of trails, campsites, backcountry campsites, picnic grounds, buildings, roadways, abandoned mines, intermittent streams. There's just tons of information on here. I really suggest that every scout take some time truly getting to understand what all the symbols and lines on a map mean. You also got to look at the key of the map. This is how you know how to interpret all the information. What's the scale of the map? An inch on one map might be 5 miles. An inch on another map might be 20 miles. You can tell how far you need to hike or how far you have hiked. There is so much information on these. Also, very important information that you'll need to know to utilize a map with a compass. But again, I started this section about maps that you could navigate even without a compass. And this is one of the most basic principles about wilderness navigation. And that's not how to find yourself when you're lost, but just not getting lost to begin with. It might seem a little corny or cliche, but one of the things to do is to be able to know where you're starting from and literally on the map, know that I'm right here. And as you're walking down the trail, I'm right here. You keep walking down the trail, I'm right here. Again, with a good map and constantly using it, you can navigate a well-maintained wilderness trail system without ever pulling out a compass, simply looking at the mountains or topography around you and always knowing where you are. There's a great book called Staying Found that I highly suggest people who are interested, especially in maps, but also map and compass use, that you look up that book and that mentality of not just knowing how to find yourself when you're lost, but how to always stay found. We'll have more scout skills about the compass specifically, and then how to utilize that compass with a map next week.
You might get dirty when you go camping, but you don't have to stay dirty. Whether you like a daily shower or you're more of an occasional bather, there are easy ways to keep yourself and your drinking water clean on your next trip, even when there's no shower in sight.
You don't need much to make a cleanup kit. A water container, biodegradable soap, and maybe a bandana, washcloth, or small towel.
Get water from a nearby river, stream, or lake. You can use whatever container you have to carry your water.
To protect your privacy and your drinking water, walk at least 200 feet away from where you got your water and from campsites and trails. We do this because even biodegradable soap can harm aquatic life.
You can just use your hands
or a bandana, washcloth, or small towel with a few drops of soap. You can use a squirt bottle to help get your nooks and crannies.
Lather up, then rinse.
And scatter any soapy water like this.
If you have a hydration reservoir or a dromedary bag, you can make your own outdoor shower.
When there's not a lot of water nearby, wipes work great too. Just make sure to pack them out when you're done. Have fun, stay clean,
and leave no trace.
Hello, it's Matthew from the Crossroads of America Council, and today's Scout Skill of the Day, and also my favorite knot Monday, is the tot line. This is one of the most useful knots in scouting and outside of scouting. It can be used for many things like tightening down a tent, tightening down a shelter, really any time that you need a loop that can be tightened or loosened accordingly while maintaining that loop and that tension, this is the knot that you want to use. Like I said, very important and very helpful. So, I have started by making a loop on right here on my deck, and I'm going to loop that. I am then going to take our working end, cross over the end, go once, and go twice through the loop. So you'll have two bites, as we would call it, right there. You can see that I have two bites on this non-working end and our working end. We'll then cross over those two, and then we will feed back through. Now this is the key. You're going to feed back through that loop that you just made right through there. Okay. So now this rope is a little large, so it's hard for me to tighten, but all you need to do is tighten down the rope by pulling both ends. And then as you can see, the rope will maintain tension. So I can tighten, I can loosen, I can tighten this loop however I need to. That's why it's so helpful for a tent, and then it'll stay and hold. The loop won't move as long as you've got this tightened down really well. So we're gonna go over that one more time on how to tie that knot. So we start with the loop, take our working end, create a bite, fold it over, and then we'll go inside once, inside twice. So we have two bites. You can see them right there, one, two. And then we'll take our working end and go over those two bites that we just made, and then up through the inside of that loop we just created. And right there, there you go. Super easy, super helpful. Yet again, you've got another tot line right there. Like I said, super helpful knot, and it holds the loop so that you can use it to tighten or loosen something that you need to really tie down really well. So thank you for watching today's Scout Skill of the Day, and see you tomorrow.
Good afternoon, Scouts and Scouters. I'm so super excited to hear so many of you are doing your own campouts this weekend. And how fun would it be to actually make your very own popcorn that you can have with your s'mores, or maybe you're going to watch a movie while you're camping in your tent. So what I wanted to do is just kind of give you a couple of tips that you can do to make some popcorn. Of course, we have to have our fancy, wonderful trails in popcorn. So what I have here is a microwave style that you can just kind of cook in the microwave, but I wanted to kind of tell you a little bit about the seasonings. I mean, there's so many different flavors that you can maybe add to it. Right now we have a taco seasoning. Yummy. So you can just pop your popcorn and just sprinkle it on a little bit, shake it up, and if you want more, add as much as you want. But there's ranch flavors, there's all kinds of extra seasonings that you can add to make it fun and unique for your own taste. But also, if you have the wonderful kernel style popcorn and you don't have the microwave, you can make your very own microwave out of kernel seeds. So you can just get a brown bag and you can measure out a little bit, maybe about a quarter cup, dump it in your bag. You can put any kind of oil that you would prefer, cocoa, any kind of oil in that bag, roll it up a few times, and you can actually microwave your own popcorn from the extra kernels. Salt it, season it, any kind you want. So I'm so excited to maybe see some of you and work with some of you this season, because that is right around the corner, and so you'll be registering and you'll be getting trained, and that way you'll be able to sell and get your own popcorn. Have fun this weekend. I can't wait to see you guys soon.
Well, hello everyone, and welcome back to another edition of Scout Skill of the Day. We really appreciate how energized and enthusiastic you've been about completing each Scout Skill each day, and we are trying a new format today as we look at a series we're going to create over the next couple of weeks that we like to call Thankful Tuesday. So today I wanted to take a moment and discuss the Scout slogan, which is Do a Good Turn Daily. Now, if you are newer to scouting and have never heard the story of why our slogan is Do a Good Turn Daily, it actually goes back to our founder, William D. Boyce. In 1909, William D. Boyce traveled to London, England, and lost his way in dense fog. He stopped under a lamp and tried to figure out where he was, at which point he was approached by a young boy who asked, "Can I help you, sir?" This boy guided Mr. Boyce to his destination, and Mr. Boyce reached into his pocket to extend a tip, and this boy stopped him and said, "No, thank you, sir. I can't take anything for helping, for I am a scout." And this boy told the American businessman about himself and his fellow scouts, at which point William D. Boyce was so impressed that he had to meet Lord Robert Baden-Powell, and from that conversation brought scouting back and founded the Boy Scouts of America the very next year. So what does that have to do with us today? Well, I think we have an awful lot to be thankful for in our current challenges and situations that we find ourselves in the community. And I think that one of the best things about scouting is not just thinking about how scouts can help us, but how we can continue to help those around us. So one of the things that I would like us to do this week, think about who could we be thankful for. There are a lot of hardworking individuals in each of our community who probably are a little bit tired at this point. And even just a brief, meaningful thank you can really brighten someone's day. So for Thankful Tuesday, we want to think about who can we be thankful for. Maybe it is our local grocery store who have been going above and beyond to support all of our families. Maybe it's the other professionals in our communities who have evolved the way that they conduct business on a daily basis to keep the services and systems going that we have come to expect in each of our communities. People like our medical professionals, our postal workers, and our teachers, who especially have been evolving their skills to help teach from home. So how can we show our thanks? There are many ways in this day and age to show our thanks. We could write a thank you card, go the old-fashioned way for some of you younger scouts, and maybe the normal way for some of our adult leaders. We could post a meaningful message to social media. And for those of you who might be working on Art Merit Badge or a Cub Scout Adventure, maybe utilizing your artistic skills to create some artwork that you could either take a picture of or send to a local grocery store, share with your postal worker, or talk with your teacher if you are doing some online classroom. Just share the thank you during that time with your teacher even. There's many different ways that we can show our thanks, and on this Thankful Tuesday, I would encourage all of our scouts to do just that. Be creative, work with your parent, make sure you are sharing all of these messages appropriately, following the cyber chip guidelines, and we will see you very soon for another edition of Scout Skill of the Day. Thanks for participating in this Thankful Tuesday. Make sure that you are sharing your thank yous with us using the hashtag CACImpact. And also, please make sure that you challenge your fellow members of your Denner Patrol to thank someone this week. Have a great day, everyone.
How's it going, Scouts and Scouters? My name is Matt Hostel. I am the Firecrafter Council Chief and the Firecrafter Area Director at Ransbury Scout Reservation. Firecrafter is an organization based upon three ideals: friendship, leadership, and service. And today I'm going to show you and explain to you one of the most important leadership tools you have at your disposal. It's called the EDGE method. EDGE stands for explain, demonstrate, guide, and enable. And to show you all the EDGE method, I'm going to teach you how to tie the square knot using the EDGE method. So explain is when you tell the person you're teaching about why the skill you're learning is important and how to do it. So the square knot is used to connect two ropes of the same or similar diameter. It's one of the most useful and simple knots that you'll learn in Scouts. Now I'm going to demonstrate to you how to tie the square knot. This is when you go through each step slowly so that the person you're teaching can learn, you know, how to actually do it. So when you tie the square knot, you have a working end and you have a stationary end. And the working end is going to be your right side. and you're going to cross them, and you're going to go right over left. So you have this little cross section here, and then you go left over right, and you go through. Then you hold on to both ends of the rope and you pull tight, and that's your square knot. Now that I've demonstrated to you how to tie the square knot, I'm going to guide you along the way. And when you guide the person you're teaching, that's when you allow them to attempt the skill and you help them along the way when they have any questions or any hangups while they're working on the skill. This step can be repeated multiple times, and it will be repeated multiple times because you want to be able to get to a point where you can enable them. That's the last step. Enabling is when you allow them to practice the skill without any help or without much help. This is when you focus on the mastery portion of the skill. So when enabling them to tie the square knot, after I've helped you along the way, you will attempt to square it out by yourself. Now that I've explained to you the edge method, we're gonna recap really quick what each step means, and then we'll go from there. So explain is the first step. You tell the person about the skill and why it's important. Then you demonstrate. You go through each step slowly so that the person can follow along and see what's going on. Then you guide. That's when they actually attempt the skill with your help. If they have any questions or if they get hung up on any part, then you can step in and help them. And this step can be repeated multiple times. Then you enable. After you've guided them for a while and they get to the point where they think they can tie it on their own, enabling is when they actually tie the knot on their own or do whatever skill that you may be doing. This is a very useful tool as a leader, and I hope that we can bring it all back to our troops and help each other become better teachers, learners, and leaders. If you want to learn more about Firecrafter, be sure to stop by the Firecrafter area at summer camp, or you can go to www.firecrafter.org to learn more about the organization, what we're about, and how to join. Thanks everyone, and be sure to tune in next time for another useful scout skill.
So you can go ahead and take a seat on your mat, and you don't have to have a mat. It can be a blanket, you could just be on the carpet, anything that gives you a little bit of cushion from the floor. So go ahead and bring your hands into your chest. We are going to take a few slow, deep breaths through our nose. So starting with an inhale, pause, and then exhale. When you inhale, you want to start kind of at the base of your lungs or your stomach. Fill up through your ribs, through your chest. Pause. Exhale through all of those cavities. Just take a few more breaths and kind of assess how you are feeling. Now I want you, on your last exhale, to bring your hands up overhead. We're going to take our right hand down to the floor and stretch through our left side body. So in this posture, you want to make sure that you're not falling into this rib cage, and you're able to stretch all the way through this side. Hands back up to center. And then we're going to put our left hand on the ground and our right hand over and take a few breaths here. Then hands back up to center, and I want you to put your left hand on your right knee and your right hand right behind your spine. So in this posture, you want to make sure you can keep your spine straight and your abs tucked in. Inhale, and as you exhale, kind of twist a little bit deeper. We're going to take 5 breaths here. And then the last exhale, bring your hands back over center. Right hand on your left knee, left hand behind your shoulder. going to roll onto our hands and knees. So in this, you want to be able to fill out your hands so that you're right in the center of your hand. And this is called tabletop. And we're just going to roll through a couple half cow hops. So you inhale, come up into your cat posture. And exhale out into your cow posture. In this, you still want to keep your abdominals tight. That way you can keep pressure off your spine. We will do this 5 times.
Hello and welcome to My Favorite Not Monday. My name's Matthew and I'm with the Crossroads America Council, and today we're going to be learning about the sheep bend. So similar to the square knot, the sheep bend is really used to hold two ropes together. So for example, I've tied a square knot here. Of course, you can tell that it's a square knot. You can move them back and forth, still forms a square knot. Both ends are on the same side of the knot. So we've got two ends over here and two knots in over here. Now, so that is the square knot. Of course, we've talked about how to tie that knot. But similar to the square knot, the sheep bend is used to connect two types of rope. Now, the sheep bend is especially useful when tying two different types of rope together. So two different sizes, maybe even two different types of rope, such as natural or synthetic rope. Sometimes when tying those ropes together, a square knot will just not cut it. It'll just slip and slide and will not hold strength in that knot. So a way to deal with this is the sheep bend. So the sheep bend is a really simple knot. I'm going to be using actually the same size rope. It's actually the same rope. I'm just using two different ends of the rope. But it works either way with the same size or a different size rope. But like I said, the best purpose is for when it's two different sizes. So we'll make a bite. All it is a little loop at the end of one of our ends of our rope. Just a bite. So we've got a loop here. We're going to take our working end and we're going to feed it through the bite. Okay, feed it through the bite, and then all we're going to do is wrap that rope all the way around, encompassing both ends of the bite. So we got both ends of the bite around, and then we're going to take that working end and just feed it right underneath of itself. So right underneath of itself, and then we'll pull tight. So we can see that it even looks a little similar to a square knot. We got two ends right here, but then this is where it changes. You do not see this in a square knot. So this is just to make it so the rope won't slide. It won't feed back through itself. It won't do that fancy trick without pulling through in a square knot. So we can see there's a great knot for tying two different size ropes together, or in this case, same size rope, but works just the same. Now we're going to tie that one more time. So we got our bite. We have our working end. We will feed the working end through the loop. We'll feed it through the loop. We will then work around the bite. We'll take that working in around the bite and then right through underneath of itself. So we can see that's our working in. We're just gonna feed it right underneath there. There we go. Pull tight. There you go, you've got the sheet bin. Thanks for watching and see you guys tomorrow for the next Scout Skill of the Day.
Are you a Leave No Trace camper?
Take the Camp Oh No Challenge.
Check out this campsite. What would you do to make it more Leave No Trace?
Stay tuned to see if you found everything.
How'd you do?
Let's check it out. We love wildflowers, but no one loves a teepee bloom. Pee far away from your campsite and throw toilet paper in the trash can.
Animals will investigate anything with a smell, so keep your food and other items that smell stored safely away from wildlife. That goes for your trash too.
Food and trash in a campfire hardly ever burn all the way down, and the scent attracts animals. Plus, would you want a campfire this close to your tent?
Washing yourself and your dishes in the stream might get you cleaned up, but so pollutes the water, and it can harm aquatic creatures.
Tents can kill plants, so set up your tent on bare dirt when you can.
We think nature's pretty neat, but even rocks can be shelter for wildlife, so it's best to leave things where you find them.
Not everyone loves the same music. So be a good camp neighbor and keep the volume low. Do you teach Leave No Trace?
Click on the link below to see how you can set up your own Camp Oh No. You know you could just deflate that.
Oh, yeah. Hey Matt, time to film.
My name's Matthew, and today we're doing flag folding for our Scout Skill of the Day. Matt here is going to help us, and we're going to walk through the process in folding an American flag. We start with the flag out and displayed. We will then fold it in half, and we will fold it so that the stripes are up, as you can see here. Then we'll fold it in half again. We'll make sure that the seams on the edge are really well covered. And then we'll start on my end over here by forming a triangle. This is kind of a repetitive process, so I'm not gonna repeat each step, but we're forming a triangle and folding it over.
And that point goes towards the person you're folding it to. So see when there's a point at the end, Matthew then folds it towards me. Now when you get to about here, that is where you're gonna finish it. So you can fold the ends in and then wrap under that fold, trying to get as much of the red out as possible. We don't want any red showing if we can avoid it. And then if we hand that to Matthew, he will then hold the flag as such.
And this is the proper way to hold a flag.
We'll see you next time on the Scout Skill of the Day.
Thank you.
My name is John Melton, and I'm a scouting volunteer and a Leave No Trace master educator. I wanted to give you guys some tips this weekend that you can use that will help you practice Leave No Trace while you're camping in your backyard. If you've ever been to one of our training events, you might have received one of our hang tags from the Leave No Trace Center for youth or for older scouts and adults. If you have these hang tags, now would be a great time to review them. They have all seven principles of Leave No Trace and some details on what you can do to follow them. The first principle that I'd like to talk about is plan ahead and prepare. I would encourage you to plan for this activity like it is any other camp out and try to take all the materials that you need and everything that you might use for the activities you have planned for this camp out and try to take them with you when you first go out to avoid unnecessary trips to the house. It'll give you a really good idea to see how well you really did plan ahead and prepare. The next principle is minimize campfire impacts. If you're going to cook over a fire, or if you're going to have a fire for social events or activities, or you're going to make s'mores, now would be a great time to practice this principle. If you have a backyard fire pit, that's a great place to do that. If not, you can use a metal feed pan and some bricks, or you can designate a spot in your yard to have a campfire and then clean it up properly. If you want some advanced techniques, you can go to the internet with your parents' permission and learn how to build a mound fire. Either way, any of those skills that you practice with your fire will help you minimize those impacts. Another principle, leave no trace, is leave what you find. If you participate with your family in the neighborhood scavenger hunt this weekend, it's a great opportunity to practice that skill. Rather than take the item that you find, you can take a picture of it in its place and count that as finding the item. Or if you do take it, make sure you return it to its original place so that others can see it in that environment. There are other principles that you can follow as well. And for more detail on those principles, refer to your hang tag, your scout handbook, or lnt.org. Enjoy your camp out this weekend.
We have four objectives when it comes to properly disposing of human waste. First, we want to minimize the contamination of water. Second, minimize social and aesthetic impacts. Third, we want to minimize the spread of disease. And fourth, we want to maximize decomposition. When we're unable to achieve one or more of those objectives, it's best if we pack out our waste. One way to do so is with a wag bag. Some places where it's best to pack out your waste include alpine and winter environments, rivers and canyons, oceans and lakes, big walls, and even really popular trails.
Always check local regulations.
Start by opening the double bag system. They generally come with just enough TP to get your fingers dirty, so pack some extra.
These magic crystals inside gel your waste and render it inert. Might need to make yourself a throne with rocks or logs for comfort and to anchor the bag. Now squat and get her done.
Once you're done with your business, you can just deposit the toilet paper right in the bag. Go ahead and roll that up nice and tight. Oh, getting all that air out of there and seal it up. When you're done, make sure you pack it out by hiding it in your friend's pack.
Just don't forget about it like you usually do with your banana peels. Then properly dispose of it in a trash can. And don't forget to wash your hands.
Hi everyone, my name is Spencer and I work for the STEM Scouts program at the Crossroads America Council. Today I'm going to demonstrate this fun STEM activity you can do at your home. We're gonna make a penny boat. So, penny boats are as simple as they seem. They only take a few things for you to get started. You need aluminum foil, which is something hopefully you have at home in your kitchen. You need pennies or another coin, something flat and a little heavy. You need some water. It could be your bathtub, your kitchen sink, or like I have, just a clear, just a container here today. So, penny boats are all about testing. So we're gonna test the question of how many pennies can you fit in your boat before it sinks. So we're starting with a 6x6-ish sheet of aluminum foil that we're gonna fold into a boat. Your boat can be whatever you want it to be. So I'm gonna fold mine up into a fun semi canoe shape with a flat bottom. I'm going to make sure that a boat, it has to do two things. First, I'm going to verify, hey, it floats. We did it. Now, does it hold pennies? Is that what you think? So, we're going to count it out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Well, you get the idea. I'm gonna keep going with my pennies. But test, build your own boat. Take photos. Which boat compete with your sibling? Maybe mom and dad can try and make a boat too. How many pennies can you fit in the boat that you build? I'd love to find out. Thanks everyone, have a great day.
Hello, my name is Matthew, and today's scout skill of the day is fire building. Of course, as always, we're gonna start with a brief safety moment. Just a reminder, make sure that you have a fire bucket filled with an appropriate amount of water for the fire that you're building, just in case it does come out of control, you're able to put it out. So, we're gonna, of course, start with the basics of, you know, with the different types of materials, and this is the first type, tendering. So we've got kind of three different examples. This is just a rope that we've kind of torn apart, a natural rope. Really, really good for starting fires. This is an example of like wood shavings. This could be anything from sawdust to wood shavings from a wood project. And of course you have your natural, what we found in the woods. This is your smallest that you can find. At the biggest, probably a toothpick. We've got some small, some bigger stuff and some smaller stuff. But this is really, all these three examples right here is kind of the heart of starting the fire. You could use newspaper, paper, anything else would really start to get this going. Our next step right here is kindling. Now there's some differing opinions on how large kindling is, but usually about the size of a pinky is usually where you start looking at. And this is really where you move from the tendering and to the kindling to really get that fire really going and really started. Next we have right here is our fuel. So this would be our larger sticks. They can be much larger depending on the size of the fire, anywhere from a thumb to much larger. An example right here is the start of a cabin style fire. And this is more examples of fuel. These are much bigger than these sticks. Really kind of the last step in the fire building process, starting from the smallest, working all the way up to the top. As always, we've got a couple different lighting materials. You got a lighter, you have matches. However you choose to light it, you really need to be focusing in on lighting these materials first. And depending on how you lay the fire itself, you need to focus on these materials first, then moving upwards towards your fuel. As always, just make sure that you are talking with your parents prior to starting any fires or building any fires, making sure that they're aware of what you're doing. And don't forget to like and share this video with your troop, pack, den, and district. And we'll see you next time. Thank you.
More and more people are coming to recreate outdoors every year. The National Park Service has 300 million people each year. If those people were to leave a trace of their visit, the impact of the land would be enormous.
We're leaving such a mark on the land. The integrity of the wildlands is compromised.
It was my responsibility, basically, is also to be a steward of the land, the places that I enjoy, too.
It's a legacy we pass on, and each of us can take care of it no matter where we are.
It's an ethic or an attitude you have towards your surroundings and how you take care of it.
Part of it is having a passion for the wilderness and the backcountry.
It comes down to a very conscious effort of making good judgments, being aware of how you can individually minimize any potential impacts to the land.
You came there because you know it's nice and you want it to be that way. Wouldn't it be nice for it to be that way for the next person?
Leave No Trace is really sort of thinking about the future, not tomorrow, the day after tomorrow.
Chance to do my part to take care of the outdoors.
Planning ahead and preparing is a really key part to leaving no trace in the backcountry.
If you plan ahead and prepare, and you plan to minimize your impacts.
Even if you have a tremendous land ethic, if you fail to plan your trip properly, can force the most experienced person into making bad decisions.
Because what you do before you leave home will guarantee the success or failure of that particular trip.
When you're traveling in the backcountry, it's very important that you're aware of your surroundings and what you're hiking on.
Whether you're canoeing or backpacking or walking up a trail, you're going to be interfacing with the ground, and that can have some trampling potential.
Vegetation in many of our areas is getting hammered.
Impacts in the outdoors are individual and they're cumulative.
It's not just their footprint, but it's the thousand of prints that will come after them.
We can have a lot of trampling effect where we camp. You know, we have where we cook, we have where we sleep, we have where we maybe put our backpacks. But in general, if we concentrate our use in those durable areas, we will leave no trace.
The ethic is, leave the area better than you found it.
Because it really challenges users to get out there and take everything out that they brought in. To draw the line and say, hey, I brought it, I'm going to take it out with me, because these wildlands are important enough to me that I can't leave anything.
It was implausible to me almost that people would feel that it was okay to leave the trash there.
Human waste, what we do with it can be one of the biggest impacts that we can make out there. It's a social impact, it can be a disease impact, it can be a water quality impact. All too many of us have seen plenty of toilet paper spread around the backcountry and the stuff that goes with it. One of the principles of Leave No Trace is to leave what you find. And that means that everything that you find out there in the backcountry, whether it's plants and rocks and sometimes artifacts, it needs to stay there. They're part of the historic context, they're part of the natural context of what's going on in the backcountry. And it may look pretty nifty on your shelf at home, but it really belongs in the environment from where it came. That's where it derives its power.
But campfires are a very enjoyable thing.
But you really have to think about what are the regulations? And then even if a campfire is allowed, you have to look at soil conditions, fire danger, where is the wood going to come from? If you are going to have a fire, there are several different leave no trace techniques.
Going into the backcountry with the expectation that you're going to enjoy the resource as it is, enjoy the night sky and the night sounds, and just rethink the idea of having a campfire. Is it really necessary? Or are there alternatives that you can use to enjoy the nighttime of the areas you're visiting?
All wild creatures deserve a chance to function in a normal, natural way.
This is their habitat. I think we should go to extra measures to be sure that we don't disturb their natural behavior.
And it's well known that feeding animals human-type food can habituate them to human activities, cause them to lose their fear of humans. If any creature loses its fear of humans, it's quite more likely to meet with some sort of ill fate. So it's best to enjoy wildlife at a distance.
A
what you do not just affects your particular trip, but everybody else who comes.
We need to be conscious of our sound, of our visibility. Most people, when they go in the out-of-doors, don't do it to see a bunch of folks.
Just because it's the one weekend a year they're taking advantage of that place doesn't mean that every weekend of the year there aren't other people in there.
So to the degree that you can be unobtrusive, to the degree that you can get out of sight of other people and out of sound, that helps us all enjoy the backcountry without the knowledge and the appearance that there are a whole lot of folks visiting at any one time.
Trace is important to me because it helps to maintain the integrity of our wildlands.
Backcountry is pretty real. That's one of the neat things about it. The consequences of our actions are very real.
And that's where Leave No Trace comes in. It tries to heighten an ethic.
All right. Hello, everybody. My name is Frank Russell. I'm an Eagle Scout from Findlay, Ohio. I'm originally from Troop 304, based out of Findlay First Presbyterian Church. My last three summers, I spent my time at the Philmont Scout Ranch working as a ranger. This summer, I hope to return for my fourth summer in the ranger department. That's all dependent on the current COVID-19 pandemic. So today, I'm going to be talking about some basic orienteering skills. And then we're going to move on and talk about my time at Philmont, and I can answer any questions that you might have. So, as I posted earlier, some of the things that you might want to bring with you for today's lesson is a compass. I have mine right here. A map. I have my Philmont Scout Ranch map. And one thing that I have that you probably don't have is a ranger handbook. So the reason I have this is it has a bunch of useful tips in it that allows me to help crews learn and to educate them better out in Philmont. So, we're gonna flip to the right page here and get all set up. So the first thing I wanna talk about is your compass. Compasses are very important for the backcountry. It helps you determine which way to go. You always need to be able to find what true north is. And the way to find true north is to use what's called a declination. So a declination is the difference between true north, which is up and down, and magnetic north, which is generally at an angle. As we learned in science class, the Earth sits at a tilt, and that polarity throws off the compass, creating a difference from true north to magnetic north. So it's very important that you adjust your compass, to this in-between called the declination, and that's what allows us to orient our map properly. So I look at my map, you can find this on Google, and you can go and find out where you are and find the proper declination. So the declination for Ohio is 6 degrees to the west. Now I want to keep that in mind as I orient my map. So the first thing I want to do is I want to look at my compass and look at the small numbers that are on the outside of it. And I'm going to twist that dial 6 degrees to the west. And once I have that lined up, I now have my compass set in the right direction. So next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take it, I'm going to set it down on my map, and I'm going to line up the edges with my map and make sure the map on the compass is facing the same direction as my compass itself. So if you see here, this is the compass on the map, and this is my compass right here. Now, if you look at the compass, you notice the red northern arrow and the red outline right here. So as a quick way to remember it, we call this Fred, and the outline is the shed. And we always want to put red Fred in the shed. So the way we're going to do this is by keeping this in line with the north part of the map and in line with the edges. We're going to twist the map and just keep on twisting it. Keep on twisting until Red Fred is in the shed. So now he's back in that outline and we are declinated. So our map is now pointed towards the true north that we want to be following. So why this is important is, say you're hiking along a trail and you come to a T in the road and you don't know if you want to go left or right. If you pull out your map and you look at it, you might not have it correctly oriented, could throw off which way you go, and you could hike several miles the wrong direction. So by orienting your map, you're able to better see which way you need to go and follow the trail in a proper fashion. The next thing that we're going to talk about is called declination. So again, this uses your compass, and this is used when you're hiking in areas that don't have good trails or you're afraid that you might lose the trail along the way. So what you want to do is you want to get to someplace high, a hill or a cliff or something, and see where you're trying to go. And then what you're going to do is you're going to take that black arrow in your compass and you're going to point it at it. It's really important not to point your compass up or to point your compass down or to have it any other way. You want to have it as flat as possible. So I like to do this by putting it in the palm of my hand. So what I'm going to do, if I'm imagining I'm shooting a bearing just straight ahead of me right at the camera, is I'm going to twist Red Fred's shed until Red Fred is back in his shed. So what this means for me is if I walk straight, he will stay in his shed. But if I turn in one direction or the other, that means he's going to come out. And that tells me that I've walked off my set course. So this is very helpful if I'm walking through a wooded area where I might not be able to see my destination or I might run out of the trail. It's very important that when you initially set this, you see where you're going to go and you understand how this is going to function. One important thing to remember is you do not want to use declination for shooting a bearing. By using declination, you throw off your original line of sight, and it can end up hurting you along the way. So declination is important for orienting your map. You always want to look up on Google what the declination is for the area you're going to be hiking. And then for shooting a bearing, this is especially important when you're hiking in uncertain areas and you're afraid you might lose the trail. Make sure to always orient your map at every sort of crossing or intersection so you know which way to go. And use a bearing whenever you're unsure of if you're going to be able to follow the trail. That's all I have about basic orienteering. These are skills that we teach at Philmont, and I've taught to many crews that I've worked with. It's very important out there because they are hiking on their own and they are going to be in different areas of the ranch they might not be familiar with. And so we ask crews to use this to have a safe experience. So a little bit about Philmont. It's a 12-day backpacking experience for Boy Scouts, Venture Scouts, and other scouting troops or programs to come out and hike. There are various ways to go out there individually. There's a program through the Ranger Department called Rayado that has a 21-day backpacking experience. You yourself go and you are joined with other individuals from across the country and sent out with two rangers as your guide. It's a phenomenal experience. I've had plenty of friends that do it and they've absolutely had a blast. Another way is the OATC, the Order of the Arrow Trail Crew. This is a way for OA members to go out and advance in the OA while doing service projects for the ranch. Both of these options allow you to see the various parts of the ranch to form a better connection with various people that you meet out there. And the third, and my personal favorite, is to come back on staff. Like I've said, I've worked out there for 3 years at the ranch and I've had a lot of fun. I've been able to meet someone from every state and from abroad out there. I've been able to show youths and other adults what it is that makes that place so special. And it's really neat to be able to meet other people from throughout my life that have been to Philmont, and we instantly have something to talk about. It's an instant connection that you will have with any other Boy Scout or Boy Scout affiliate that's been to Philmont, It's a lasting brotherhood that is just unmatched with anything. And my personal opinion, it is the pinnacle of scouting to be hiking out there with your food and everything on your back. And then you can use the skills that you've learned through the Boy Scouts, such as knot tying and map reading and various other things. So with that, if you have any questions, please feel free to post them. I'd be more than happy to answer them. And we'll take a couple minutes to wait until some questions filter in.
First question, where is Philmont?
So my cameraman had a question. His question is, where is Philmont? Philmont is located in Cimarron, New Mexico. Some ways to get out there, when my brother went, he went with our hometown troop, and they actually drove out there in a big bus and stopped along the way. When I went, we took the Amtrak through Chicago, and then took the Amtrak from Chicago. It goes through to California, so we stopped off in Raton, New Mexico, and took a bus in. Other crews have flown in and then taken a bus from the Denver or Albuquerque airport and driven to the ranch. So there are various methods to get out there. Some of them are a little bit more fast, others allow you to see other parts of the country. It's really up to your crew on what you guys think is best. Like I said, post any questions you might have, and I'd be more than happy to answer them. Otherwise, I can just keep on talking about the various high adventure bases. There's also the Summit Bechtel Reserve. I was able to go there for the National Jamboree. It was a phenomenal experience. I highly recommend going for a Jamboree, but Philmont is still my all-time favorite.
How big is Philmont?
What is your most favorite? So Philmont is several thousand acres. I'm not sure on the exact dimensions. When I'm on staff, I do know because a lot of crews ask that. See, a question has come in. My most memorable experience on staff was actually when I was there. I'd say 2 years ago, there was a forest fire. The Ute Park forest fire burned in the middle of Philmont and separated the ranch into two different pieces. And we got back from the fire. What we did was we did something called TSI, Timber Stand Improvement. And we had Boy Scouts working to improve the ranch all summer. Unfortunately, we had to close. So we cut down trees to make shaded cover breaks. So Scouts would be hiking there for the next 100 years would have a safe exit. We wanted to ensure the safety of future Scouts by working hard that summer and creating those shaded cover breaks. I see another question has come in. Give me a quick sec. Oh, so I've been asked to go over the compass stuff again. Sure, I'd be more than happy to do that. So a quick refresher. The first thing you want to do is you want to have your compass. That's obviously this right here. And before you head out on a hike, you want to check what's called a declination map. So a declination map, it can be found on Google. I have mine in my Ranger handbook. And it's just a simple map with some lines through it showing the difference between true north and then magnetic north. Magnetic north is set by the axis of the earth. And so the north that you want to use for hiking is the distance in between. So for here in Ohio, it's about 6 degrees to the west. So you look at your compass, and what you're going to do is you're going to twist it so that it's 6 degrees to the west. And after you've twisted it so it's 6 degrees to the west, you now have it perfectly lined up. Next step is to find this red outline on your compass, and that's going to be called the shed. The red northern arrow right there is we call Fred. So the object of orienting your map is always going to be putting red Fred in his shed. So when you put the map on the compass, or you put the compass on the map, you want to make sure that your lines are in edge and you are able to line it up with the compass on the map. So I'm going to put it down, fly towards you guys so you can see. So I'm going to put it down here. It's going to be in line with this edge and this side edge right here. It's also going to be matching up with the compass on the map. So what I'm going to do, it's already oriented, so I'm going to unorient it real quick so you can see it work. Red Fred wants to be in his shed. So I'm going to twist the map and keep on twisting it until Red Fred goes in his shed. And now I know that my map is oriented for the north that I want, not magnetic north or true north, but the declinated north in the middle. And this allows me to make better decisions when I come to a crossing or a T on the trail. The second thing that we went over is called shooting a bearing. Shooting a bearing is important for when you're afraid you might lose the trail or you might go into a wooded area where you're not be able to see the destination. So if you're on a ridgeline or on top of a hill, you can look out and see where you're trying to go. Then you're going to take this black arrow right here and you're going to aim it at where you're going to go. You don't want to have it up, you don't want to have it down, you don't want to have it any sort of cattywampus way. And once you've aimed it, you're going to twist the dial that we talked about earlier till Red Fred is in the shed. This allows you to walk in that straight line without that compass moving. If you fall off to one side or the other, the northern arrow will come askew and it tells you that you have walked in the wrong direction. And you just turn your body back in the right way and it'll allow you to keep on going on that straight path you set originally. So at Philmont, this is really useful when you're hiking in our low impact areas that don't have trails, but you can still see where you're trying to go when you're on top of a ridgeline. And so we teach crews these skills in order to make better decisions while they're on the trail. Someone posted the acreage of Philmont. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. It is 140,000 acres. We also have land grants with the surrounding area. Ted Turner, the founder of CNN, I believe, lets us use his land. Several other ranches in the surrounding area also let us use their land as part of land use agreements, especially after the forest fire that I mentioned earlier. If you have other questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them. Just feel free to ask in the comments. Well, I don't see any questions coming in. If you guys just post on the film on the Boy Scout page, I will be on there. I'll be more than happy to answer them in the comments of this video. For people that watch later, feel free to ask those comments. I'll check the video over the next couple days and answer any questions that you might have about the Philmont backpacking experience or about any of the skills we talked about here. Thanks for watching. I really appreciate this time together. I hope to see you guys all back here soon and continue scouting. Thank you.
Compared to mountain biking or rock climbing, fishing seems pretty tame, right? Well, consider the fact that you're dealing with sharp hooks, deep water, and live critters. Like any sport, there's a safe way to play. Following a few smart guidelines will keep your fishing trips injury-free for you and for the fish. Let's start with hook safety. Try using barbless hooks, which are safer for both fish and people because they're easier to remove than barbed hooks. If you don't have barbless hooks, you can mash down a barbed hook with a pair of pliers. Any type of hook flying around can be dangerous. That's why it's always a good idea to wear a hat and eye protection when you're out fishing. To avoid hooking someone when you cast, keep about a rod's distance between you and other anglers.
Okay guys, let's stand apart just a little bit so no one gets a hook.
And check the area behind and around you before you cast to make sure it's clear. Now let's talk about water safety. Even the calmest looking body of water can have hidden dangers like drop-offs or underwater currents. To be safe, put life jackets on the little ones or anyone who doesn't swim well. Coast Guard approval, weight, and size information are printed inside the jacket. And remember, life jackets must fit snugly to be effective.
You're all set. Need to see a life jacket for everybody on board?
If you're out on a boat, Texas law requires that you have a life jacket readily accessible for every person on board, including canoes and kayaks. Kids 12 and under must have a life jacket on while the boat is underway. Now that you're safe, what about the fish? There are a few simple things that you can do to keep from injuring the fish that you catch. Try to handle fish as little as possible. Always wet your hands before touching a fish so that you won't damage its protective coating.
Go back and grow.
Big fish should never be held like this. This type of handling can hurt the fish's jaw, hindering its ability to eat.
Okay, now squeeze your thumb in there, you know.
When handling a larger fish, use both hands to support its body weight. If you're not planning on keeping your catch, release it gently back into the water as soon as possible. Keeping your fishing spot clean helps both fish and humans. Pick up your trash, including discarded fishing line. Fishing line can take hundreds of years to decompose, and fish and other critters can get tangled in it and die. If your live bait came from a bait shop or another body of water, don't throw away any that you have left over into the water.
No, sweetie, those minnows don't live in this lake. Let's take it with us.
Critters that are not natural to that water body can interfere with the plants and animals that live there naturally. If there are other anglers nearby, ask them if they would like to use your leftover bait.
Excuse me, we've got some leftover minnows. Would you like them?
Yes, thank you. We can put them in this bucket right here.
Okay, great.
Or if no one wants it, dump it in a trash can or on land away from the water. Oh, and one more thing. When fishing in the hot Texas sun, be sure to bring along plenty of water and sun protection. Fishing can be relaxing or thrilling. Don't let an accident ruin your next fishing trip. Keep it safe and you'll keep it fun.
In fishing, you have to be very patient. You might be standing out there for a while waiting for a fish to tug on your line.
It's still good if you don't get to catch a fish. It's good that they live.
Good afternoon. I'm Alan Bernard, and I'm going to tell you about some fishing spots in Northwest Ohio. It's always best to fish where the fish are. First off, let's do some little things. Get a license if you need one. You know who you are. Also, be safe and smart. Take a buddy with you and an adult. Someone's got to take the picture of the big fish. Sunscreen, water bottle, hand sanitizer, cell phone, first aid kit. All important things. Don't forget them. I know you know about them. Public areas like parks are open access. Private water, you always need to ask permission to fish on that. I'll be talking about fishing areas that I know by the district. Commodore Perry. The Maumee River, that's a great place. Right through your whole district. You've got Middle Grounds. You've got Cullen Park. Then there's also Lake Erie right beside you. You've got Maumee Bay State Park that you can do fishing off the beach. You've also got Metzger Marsh Pier, which is a great little place too. Now, you've also got another river, Ottawa. You want to do some research on that. That might be a little project for you guys. I wouldn't eat any fish if you do catch anything out of there. Eagle Bay. You're right up next to Lake Erie. Your whole northern border is Lake Erie. A lot of opportunities. You've got Cold Creek, Toussaint Creek, Turtle Creek, Portage River, and Lake Erie, obviously. There's a lot of public opportunities up there, but some you may have to pay for. You've got easy access to charters as well. The charters do cost a lot, but you're almost guaranteed a lot of good fish. Northwest, you've got Lake Olander in the Olander Park system. You've also got Sylvan Prairie Park. There's three great little lakes over there. They're hard to get to. You got to walk. You got to know about them. They're my little personal spots, but I'll tell everybody about them. There's not much fishing pressure because people don't want to walk there. Also in Northwest, there's Wiregrass Metro Park. It's a great little place, really clear water, and you can meet up with your buddies from Swan Creek because it's close to the airport. Also in Swan Creek, there's Oak Openings where you've got Mallard Lake. You've got Sidecut Metro Park right on the Maumee River. Also, there's Delta Reservoir. Delta Reservoir is farther out west, but it's a great place to learn how to fish. Really easy, really open, no trees to catch or anything. In Wood County, you've got the Maumee River right on the north end of it. You've got Buttonwood, you've got Mary Jane Thurston Park, you've got Providence Metro Park. You've also got the Portage River, which I'm not as familiar with, but it runs through southern Wood County, and I'm sure there's some great places down there. Also in Wood, because there's so much farmland, you've got a lot of farm ponds. That's private land. You want to always ask permission and get permission before you go fishing in the farm ponds. Also ask if there's any fish in there. Some are stocked better than others. Also regarding private lakes and waters, the scouts actually own our own lakes. First off, at Camp Miaconda, there's Lake Sawyer. Out at Pioneer, we've got Tea Garden, McNichol, and Lake Spiker. The thing about these lakes, we are kind of particular about when we let people fish on them. We need to have a staffed event. It's just better for everybody. We can tell you how to fish, where to fish, provide you rods and reels and so forth. If you do have any questions about that, I'm sure you can ask the rangers at either camp. Thanks a lot. You guys have a great rest of the camp in.
Hello there, Mark Stevens here, Project Fish Coordinator for Michigan State University. Today I'm going to show you how to make a hanger hook so you can work with a bunch of kids at the same time. And I make these all the time, probably made 1,000 of them or so. But I got a few tools out here for you to see, and I'll show you how to go about doing it. But first of all, we have a heavy-duty hanger. Okay, it's one of those thicker ones, not the real small ones. You probably could do it with a small one, but I think they tend to break after a while. It's got a drill, all right, with a 3/32 bit on it. I've got handy dandy crescent wrench right here, and I'll tell you the reason why we do a crescent wrench in a little bit here. I've got my cutters. I use these pruning shears. These are Cutco cutters, and this is what I use to cut the hanger. And then we've got some rope. It's a 1/8 inch. Rope. I don't know if you can see that or not, but it's a braided nylon cord, polyester cord. And I have some screw eyes. All right, they're a number 10 screw eye. And I have a lighter. I also have a pair of cutters, and I'll show you how we use those in a little bit as well. So basically, you're going to make three cuts, all right? So I'll show you. Get out the Cutco cutters. Right here in the center, doesn't matter exactly where, but just take the cutters and cut the hanger down the center, just like that, okay? Then you come up here and you go about 2 inches or so, and you cut the hanger right there. So there's one hook right there, and the second one, do this right here. You'll see what I'm doing. Cut that right there. And I've got this leftover piece, and I can show you what we do with that too. I actually cut these off right here and right here. And I use these sometimes to hang plants or something like that. It's a nice little hook. Hook it on stuff, and you can hang fishing rods from the ceiling, something like that. So there's the hook, all right? And sometimes when you cut these, there's a little hole in the center. This one does not have that, all right? You can see it doesn't have that. So that's what the drill bit is for. So what I'm gonna do is just take this drill, just start very slowly, right here in the center. Just give it a little bit of a push, not too hard, and it goes in pretty easily. You don't have to go in too far. Nice thing about this is you see this stuff? Just pick it up in one little piece and throw it in the trash. Okay, so you're done with the drill. All right, so now we got a hole in there. And we'll take one of these screw eyes. Right, like that. And we're gonna insert it in that hole and just kind of twist it a little bit. All right, and this is where I use the crescent wrench. Okay, now I use the crescent wrench because it's nice and flat. If I have a pair of pliers, you can use a pair of pliers, but I use the crescent wrench because it is flat and it doesn't chew up the little circle here. It doesn't chew up the metal, because if it does, then your rope sometimes catches on that metal and it will cause a fray. All right, and we don't want to cause a fray. And then I just kind of turn this right around. All right, bunch of times. See what I'm doing there? Sometimes this breaks. If it's an older hanger or the plastic isn't that great, sometimes it will crack. This one doesn't seem like it's going to. Right to there. I have maybe one out of 15, 20 that crack on me. So now I have this flat hanger hook. And what I like to do with it, if we're teaching knots, that are for tackle crafting, we usually use a downturned or an upturned eye, and that means the eye is downturned toward the bend, or toward the point right here. So I take this, and I will just bend it right down a little bit. See how I have that bent? Okay, and that's fairly simple. That's your hanger hook right there. So we've got one, all right? And now with the cord, let me put this down over here and I'll show you what we do with the cord. I take about 3 or 4 feet of this, usually about 4 feet. Okay, and this is what I'm gonna use the cutters for right here, is I'm gonna crimp this and use the cutters. You could use a pair of scissors too. I like to use these. Cuts it really nice and smooth. And now is when you need to heat this up, because what this will do is it will fray unless we heat it up a little bit. Okay, just like that. See what I'm doing there? Take the other end, do the same thing. See that? All right, and there we've got our hanger hook. Now, when we work with kids, we give them each one of these, and basically, when I hand them out, I'll have 24 of them or so in a classroom, you know, give one to every kid. And then what I do is I just kind of put them just a little loop and store them like that, and then I can hand them out to the kids, and it's a great way to, and then we'll come back and tie some knots with this later on. But I wanted to show you how to do a hanger hook very simply and easily. Cheaply, you can make these. They come in, these hangers come in sets of 3 or 9, and you can drill a bunch of them. You make 18 of them pretty simply and pretty easily. So thanks very much for watching, and we will come back and do some knots at another time. Bye now. Hello again, Mark Stevens here with Michigan State University's Project Fish program out of the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife at MSU. I'm here to tell you a little bit more about tying tackle, making tackle with kids. We made our hanger hook the last time, right here, the downturned eye hanger hook. And let me show you a real hook here and show you that looks quite a bit like that hanger hook. You see it there? All right, that's the downturned eye hook, and then this is the hanger hook. So we're kind of mimicking what we're doing with that tackle. Anyway, we're going to show you the parts of the hook here. Okay, there's some basic parts of the hook. Eye, downturned eye. This is the shank. Thank you very much. This is the bend or the curve. And then this is the point right here. Sometimes there's a barb on here, but I wasn't able to find barb hangers, so... anyway, there's also parts of the line too. So at the end of the line, if this was tied to your fishing line, to your rod, to your reel, through the guides of your rod, then that would be called the standing line, okay, or the main line. All right, then the end is called the tag end, and that's the one we tell kids to use. Tag, you're it. It's the one we're going to use. So What we're going to do to tie the first knot we're going to do is an improved clinch knot. Actually, we're just going to start with a clinch knot. We'll show you how we improve it afterwards. But a clinch knot is very simple. You go down through the eye here, right? And we go about 6 or 8 times around the main line. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I took that tag end, went around 4 times, but watch what I can do also. I can also twist my bait. So I can twist the hook and it causes those twists as well. So you want about 6 or 8 twists in your line. When you do that, you see this little hole right here? See that little hole that we created? We're going to stick the tag end right through that hole right there and just kind of stabilize it. Kind of hold it there for a second. And then I'm going to pull just the main line. Watch this. So it's going to clinch and it's going to clinch and it's going to clinch. Watch that. Clinch, 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 clinch. And it clinches down. And that's why they call it the clinch knot. All right. So that's the first one. Very simple to do. If you can do that with your eyes closed, you know that knot. All right. And we do that with kids. We say, okay, do it a few times and then do it with your eyes closed. And it's fun to do. And a lot of kids do that. So let's improve this clinch knot. All right, and call it the improved clinch knot. Fishermen have a lot of time on their hands, so they like to improve things. So, all right, so you take the tag end, you go around the main line. 1, 2, 3, 4. Remember, we can twist it too. A couple of times twisting. All right, put it through here, right, through that little hole. Now, if I were to pull this right now, right, that would be the clinch knot. But we're going to improve it and take that tag end, this tag end right here, okay, and put it through this hole right here because we created that hole by pulling it too. All right, so create that. Okay, and now watch what I'm going to do. I'm just going to pull this, all right, just like this. Get it started. All right, and pull that down, and that is the improved clinch knot. Instead of it just going down like that, it's going up. All right, so you just put another wrap in. It makes it a little bit stronger. And when you're using it with bigger lines, small lines, you can use that clinch knot. But if you're using bigger sized line, 10-pound test or bigger, probably do the improved clinch knot. It'll make it a little bit more strong. All right, so that's pretty simple to do. All right, we're going to show you another knot right here. All right, let me untie this one. And we're going to show you the knot called the Snell knot, all right? Very simple knot, but this one we're going to cut a piece of line, so we're going to have 2 ends, all right? So this time, we're going to go down through the eye, okay? So would this be down through the eye? Let's see here. That looks like I'm going down through the eye, but it's not. The hook is upside down, so it's not down through the eye. So we're going to go down through the eye and just hold that along the shank. Right there. Hold that along the shank. Then you're going to take your other end. The other end, because we cut a piece, we have 2 ends. Take the other end and go up through the eye a little bit. See what I'm doing there? Just a little bit. Just so it sticks out. And now I'm going to take this one, the one that it's going down through the eye. I'm going to hold it nice and short and tight. And this is important. Short and tight is important because then I'm going to wrap 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 6 to 8 times. All right. See that? And if I were to let go of this, if it's monofilament line, I let go of this would go doing, and it would uncurl. So you want to keep this short and tight. All right. And then put your finger over top and hold those wraps. Hold all these wraps in place. All right. Now I'm going to pull this all the way through. All right. Pull it all the way through. Keep holding it. Sometimes this kinks up a little bit, coils up a little bit, but yeah, there it goes. Pull it all the way through until it's nice and tight. See that? See how nice there? It's almost like a lashing. All right. All right. That is your Snell knot. All right. And what we can do with this is put beads on it and blades, shiny stuff, right? That will spin around, some attractants, some color, some shiny, because that's how fish feed. They feed by sight, feel or vibration or sound, and then they also feed by smell, and that's where you can put your smelly baits on this, you know, your worms and your minnows or some type of smell, dough balls or whatever you want to put on there for smell. So that's the snell knot. And then if we were going to decorate it with these beads and things like that for color, we'd have to tie a knot at the end. Plus, we want something to attach to the end of your line. Okay? So we're going to tie what is called an end loop knot. Okay? Very simple to do. Think of this as that's the end of the line, right? So we're going to double it over. We're going to make a new end. All right? So this is now the new end. All right? Pretend that that's just one single line. And we're going to tie this, just make a granny knot, just like that. Okay, see what I did? I made like a loop. That's my new end, that's my end. And then I'm just going to pull that nice and tight. Okay, that's an end loop knot. And now this can be attached to a swivel, or you can do an end-to-end loop at the end of your line. We could show you that later on in another series. But this is a very simple knot to tie. You could actually improve this one by going around twice. So we go around just like this. See what I'm doing? I'm going around. And then let's go through that hole one more time. Like that. Okay, and then that is another way to improve this knot or to make it stronger. So thanks very much. A couple of knots for you. We'll come back and make some real tackle the next time. We'll use some of the smaller stuff, and hopefully you'll get you out there and do some fishing with things that you made. Nothing better than catching fish with things that you made. So have a great day. Bye now. Hello there. Mark Stevens here with the Project Fish program out of the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife at Michigan State University. Today we're going to teach you how to make a pop can fishing pole. Basically, you can use a pop can. It's hand lining. Some states it's illegal to hand line, but this I think will be easy for you to use in Michigan. And it's something that's fun that you can play around with all the time. You can take it out in your backyard and play with it and get better at that cast. So here's what we're going to use. I've got a casting plug, but that could be anything. You can tie anything on the end of the line if you want. You can some nuts and bolts out of the garage, that kind of thing. Or a sinker if you have a lead sinker or a non-lead sinker. We have a Coke can, all right, or a pop can. All right, we've got a pair of nail clippers. And we've got some monofilament line. We've got 10-pound test monofilament line. Okay, it's pretty thin. You can't see that very well, but it's here, and that's what it is. So we're going to teach you a knot first, okay? And this knot is called an arbor knot, and it's a knot that you use to tie around something. So when you're starting your line onto your fishing reel, that's how it's what you would use to tie your line onto your bail. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to take, here's our demonstration line here, so it's a little bigger and easier to see. We're just going to tie a knot right in the end of that, just like that, okay? And then we're going to tie this around the line itself, all right? So I'm going to go around, so watch, I'm going to tie a knot around the line itself. So just like that, see how that slips? It's kind of like a slip knot, all right? But if it's a slip knot without this knot on it, it will pull out, okay? So I'm just going to pretend that my hand is the end of a pop can or on your bail, and so I'm going to tighten it until it hits that. See how it hits that knot and it can't pull through. All right, see how it does that? All right, and then that is called an arbor knot. It's a fairly simple knot. You can look it up online to see how to tie it. There's a lot of cool knot programs out there. And so we're going to show you how to do this. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of this line, all right, and I'm going to tie a knot right in the end, just like that. All right, and I'm going to take my nail clippers and clip off just a little piece of that tag, just like that. All right, so it doesn't get too far into my line. So now I'm going to tie this around that line. Remember, like the arbor knot. So I'm going to tie this around the line, just like that. Incorporate that knot. Give it a little pull. Just like that. See how I've got it tied on there? And that's going to slip. I'm going to put it right around my pop can, right around the ridge of the pop can, right around the top. And I'm going to pull it nice and tight. See that? And when I pull it, it's going to slip, and then it's hitting that knot and make it nice and tight, just like that. And now all I have to do is in my good hand, in my right hand, I say my good and bad hand. If I'm left-handed, that would be my good hand. But if I'm right-handed, then that's my good hand. So I'm going to take my good hand, and I'm going to grab the pop can by the hole. So I'm kind of holding it upside down, all right? And I'm going to just start holding the line with my bad hand, and I'm going to wrap that around a bunch of times. All right, I probably want to put about 30 feet of line on here. I don't know how many times that's a wrap. We could probably figure that out. You could measure the can around, and then every wrap would be that distance. And so you could do some math that way too. All right, so we're going to wrap it around a bunch of times. All right, to about right there. All right, and then I'm going to take my nail clippers and always good to have some nail clippers around so you can cut line, but then you can also, if you're bored, clip your nails. All right, so there's the end of the line on the pop can. And I'm going to take my casting plug, and I'm going to tie, remember that knot that we did before, the clinch knot? We're going to tie the improved clinch knot. So go through the eye, go 1, 2, 3, 4, remember we twisted our bait, 5, just like that, 6, 7 times. Then I'm going to take the tag end, right there, that tag end, put it through the loop that's next to the eye. Because we spun it, we created that loop. And then I'm going to take that tag end again, and I'm going to go back up through this loop right here. So I'm going to take that tag end, put it through that loop. All right, and then I'm just going to kind of tighten it a little bit, and then pull just the main line. Watch that. I'm going to pull it, and boom, that's nice and tight. All right, and that's tied right to our pop can, just like that. All right, so now I'm going to hold this. I'm going to show you here inside the house a little bit, but then you can take it outside and you can do it. So I'm going to show you real quick here. So how you do this is you take your thumb and you put it over top of that casting plug, just like that. All right, and make sure your fingers aren't holding the line on the bottom. All right, so if you're feeling line, it probably won't go out after that. So, and you're going to point the bottom of the pop can toward a target. All right, and we're going to do an underhand cast, just a little flip, and you'll get the idea of it. I'm just going to show you real quick. All right, so I'm going to do an underhand cast toward that fireplace, just like that. Okay, and then now you take your bad hand, you hold that line, all right, and you wrap. Just like that, and let the line slide through your bad hand. So you're kind of like reeling a fishing reel. Right now, you could actually put a slip bobber on here. You can put a couple of split shots and a hook and go fishing with these. It is a blast to catch bluegill and panfish, and every once in a while catch a nice bass on a pop can. It is so much fun. So try it out, get some casting in, and enjoy the outdoors. Thank you. Hello there, Mark Stevens back with you from the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife at Michigan State University. And this is the Project Fish program. We're doing some activities to help you get out and have some fun with kids. Fun stuff that we're going to do. Today, we're going to go a step further than what we did the last lesson. Remember the last lesson we did that pop can, right? The pop can caster. We're going to step up our game a little bit, and we're going to create what we call fish sticks. All right, and basically it's a PVC caster. We're going to use a cap like this. I've got a tool here. This is a cap for a PVC pipe. This is the one and one half inch PVC pipe that we have. And this is about 10 inches long. So what I did was I went up to the local hardware store, and they have scraps that they'll give you, and they'll cut them to 10 inches. At least ours will, but your local one probably will too as well. So we have those things. We have a piece of cord, all right, and we're going to use that as a lanyard. We've got these things called bobber stops. I don't know if you've ever seen those before. They're bobber stops. I'm going to show you how to put one of those on. We've got a number 6 circle hook. Let me show you what this looks like. Now, we use a circle hook because circle hooks are very safe, not only for the kids, but for the fish, because it always hooks them in their mouth. You notice how that point is down toward that shank. See that? All right. And we've got a couple of split shots. Now, split shots are weights that you put on your line, all right, and that will weight your line, okay, and that'll sink that the hook or your bait down to a different level in the lake. All right, and then we have a slip bobber. All right, now this slip bobber is actually a bobber that's got, you see, a bead right at the end there. So if you notice on these, there's beads. Now, if I were to buy a slip bobber that doesn't have a bead in it, just a hollow tube, and you can get those, then I would use the bead on this. But we're not going to this time. We're just going to use that little red thing that's there, and I'll show you how to do that in a minute. All right? Then I've got a pair of needle-nose pliers to crimp down those split shots. And these split shots happen to be non-lead split shots. We're doing a lot of that with kids, is using non-lead instead of lead. It's a little bit lighter, but it's a little safer. They're not putting it in their mouths and stuff like that. And I know when I was a kid, I used to just bite on them all the time. That's probably the way I am. I'm the way I am. So, and then we have some monofilament line and a drill bit. All right, and the drill bit's just got to be big enough so that you can put your cord through. So the first thing we're going to do is I'm going to take this cap and I'm going to drill a hole right into that cap. Watch this. All right, just like that. So that cap's got a hole in it now. All right, we'll put this away. Get the trash can out of the way. Okay, and all I'm going to do is take our cord, just like this, and put it down through this little area here, through the hole. All right, just like that. See that? I put it through the hole. I put both pieces through. And I'm going to tie a knot right at the end with both of these. Just a regular knot. An overhand knot is what they call them. Some people call them a granny knot. You got to be careful when you're teaching people. You know, those grannies get offended. So... Anyway, there's the knot, and when I pull that through, and then I have like a little lanyard, just like that. All right, so what we're going to do now is we're going to take, and it doesn't matter what knot, I've got this 10-pound monofilament line, the stuff we used for the pop can that we did the last time, and all I'm going to do is tie that to the knot, and it really doesn't matter what knot you use. You can use a bunch of different little granny knots if you want. It doesn't matter. We're just going to stabilize that, put it right inside. All right, so now I've got this monofilament line. I'll clip that tag in. This monofilament line tied to the knot. You see that? Doesn't matter where it is. All right, so now I'm going to put the cap on the PVC pipe, just like that. Now we're ready to rock and roll. Watch. Oh, forgot I got to put my hand in here if I want to do that. That way it's like a Wii controller, right? You put it around your wrist and that way it's not going to fly off into the water when you're casting. All right, so here you go. And you're just going to wrap and I'm going to put a bunch of line on there. All right, I'm wrapping, wrapping, wrapping. Yo, yo. Not that kind of wrapping. I'm sorry, a little slap happy today, but it's fun. It's a fun day. All right, make it something fun. All right, we keep wrapping, wrapping, wrapping. Put a bunch of line on there. It's all right, 40, 50 feet. Whatever, just keep wrapping, wrapping, wrapping. All right, so that's probably enough for demonstration purposes. I'm going to take my nail clippers, if I can find them. I know I put them somewhere here. There we go, clip that right off. Okay, so there we go. You got a bunch of line on there. See that? The line's wrapped around there a bunch of times. Now, I'm going to show you how to use this bobber stop. And there's a number of different kinds of bobber stops that you can use. This is the one that I use. It's called a speed bump. It's kind of fun. We get them from a local Michigan company here. All right, and so I'm going to take this. If you notice, I'm going to, see, it's got these loops. See these little loops right here? Okay, I'm going to put my line through one of those loops, and I'm going to grab, you see that red, this red thing right here? Can you see that? Okay, see it right there? See that red thing? I'm going to pull that onto the line. Okay, pull nice and hard. All right. See that? It's on the line right now, but it's not all the way through. You see that? Okay, so now I'm going to pull it right off onto the line. Just keep pulling that until it's on the line. See, now it's on the line. So that's a slip bobber. That's putting on a bobber stop. Okay, now this bobber stop, this can slide up and down the line. I can actually take that and put it any distance on the line. Okay, so now that I have that bobber stop on there, okay, I'm going to put on the slip bobber. All right, see that? I'm just going to see that orange hole right there, that orange bead. I'm going to put my monofilament line right through that orange bead. Just like this. Come on, go through there. Just like that. It comes out the other end. All right, see now I can slip this bobber all the way up and down the line, and then it will slip up and down the line till it hits that bobber stop. So we can fish any depth that we want. All right, and then I'm gonna clip on a couple of these little split shots. See a split shot right there? Okay, I'm gonna put that on the line. Oh. Sometimes I just pinch them on there really hard first. Okay, there's one, and I know I have another one here somewhere. I like to use two. Gives it a little bit more weight. I'll put another one on there for you. Right there. Crimp it down. Okay, just like that. And that's about 6 inches above where I'm going to tie on the hook. And remember the knot that we showed you the last time, we showed you that improved clinch knot. I'm going to do that with this circle hook. All right, I'm going to tie the clinch knot with the circle hook. Just go down through there. Wrap it around about 5 times. Can you see me doing that? Okay, take the tag end, put it through the loop that's right next to that. Just like that. And pull it nice and tight. See that? I'm going to clinch it until it is, whoops, tight. I didn't do that one very well. Put it through there, kind of hold it into place, and tighten it down nice and tight. There you go. Good job. All right, so now we have a rigged fishing rod. And all you do with this is you take your bobber, you put it down inside of that tube, just like that. All right, and then you can throw it out. Okay, just take that and then just kind of throw it out, flip it. All right, we'll go fishing with this and we'll show you how it works. And then you just wrap it up. Just like we did the pop can caster. There you go. And just put that bobber right down inside there. And you can store it that way. You can put a rubber band on it. What I like to do is I put a Ziploc bag over the top of it. And then that'll be there. You can go fishing anytime. You can put it in your backpack. You can put it in your boat somewhere, and if you get a really big fish and you want to keep them, you might want to bonk them on the head with it. So it's pretty fun. Anyway, it's something that you guys can do and have fun with it. If you have any questions, go ahead and shoot me an email and or comment on the Facebook post or the YouTube post, and we'll go from there. It's called a fish stick. All right, just like that. Thanks. Take care, everybody. Hello again, Mark Stevens with the Department of Fisheries and Wildlife's Project Fish Program out here at the pond, and we are going to show you how to use this fish stick, that slip bobber, couple of split shots, and then that circle hook. Now, we use the circle hook for a couple of reasons. One of the reasons is
it's safe for kids. So watch what happens here. I can, if you were to do this with a J hook, just like that, you would poke yourself every time. But see, that doesn't hook you. That point goes down toward the shank. And so that's not a problem with kids. All right. They'd have to get their finger way inside there and then pull it. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to use wax worms today. Now, wax worms are a little moth larvae, right? You see them crawling around in there, right? They're a little moth larvae, and they lay their eggs. These moths lay their eggs in beehives, and then these guys eat the wax when they hatch out of the egg. So these are larvae, and we're going to put a couple of these on. All right, and these are kind of cool. They're kind of grab them with your between your finger and thumb. Now, see, if I didn't have any bait in there, I can take my hook and just go in between my finger and thumb. You see that? You can just take your hook and put it right between your finger and thumb without hooking yourself. But then you put the bug in there and you do the same thing. You just kind of poke that bug right there and then you just slide them onto the hook. And I always like to put them on the back of the hook so that way they stay on there a little longer. And I'll put a second one on here just to give them a little bit more of a smorgasbord here. All right, just like that. So then what we're going to do is put our float and our sinkers and our split shots right down inside of this tube, just like that. All right, I'm going to go over here by the water and just make a little cast and see if we get any luck. There you go, just a little underhand flip cast like that. We'll see if anything's biting today. Oh, there we go, we got one already. How about that? So we just reel it up just like we're reeling a fishing reel. All right, this one's a nice looking bluegill, nice spring bluegill. Right there, you see that? That's kind of a nice fish. And see how that circle hook catches them right in their mouth. All right, so what we're gonna do to show you how to take this off. Now, bluegill actually have spines. All right, they're in the sunfish family, and you see those spines on there? Now, if you were just to grab that fish, it would hurt, all right, if you get poked with those. So what we do, let me show you here, is you just make a circle with your hand over top of that fish and then slide it down over top of that fish, just like that. And then that holds down all of those spines. And then you can go ahead and take that circle hook right out of that fish. And you say, thanks fish, that was a lot of fun, catch you later. So that's what we do out here. It's pretty fun. That's with a fish stick. And so if you have any questions, we're gonna post this on YouTube. If you have any questions, give me a call, shoot me an email, whatever you wanna do. All the numbers are on that. So contact me anytime you want. In the meantime, I'm gonna catch a few more fish.